sprays. Leading off and playing second base, number 8, Isaiah Byers. Batting second and playing left field, number 18, Brock Edge. Batting third and playing third base is number 13, Abraham Sequeira. Batting fourth and playing right field is number 5, Cade Westbrook. Batting fifth and playing shortstop, number 3, Aiden Swett. Batting sixth, designated hitter number 25, Trey Spratling Williams.
Welcome, everyone. We are live from Stillwell Stadium on the campus of Kennesaw State University for the conclusion of this week's A-Sun conference matchup between the visiting North Florida Ospreys and your Kennesaw State Owls. Before we meet the starting lineups, let's talk a little bit about how we got to this point. I'm Trey Fowler, joined in the booth by Jordan Griffith. And Jordan, I think the real question is today, what record does Josh Hatcher want to break this time?
You're absolutely right. And coming into the press box here today, everyone says it. Oh, we're going to get a third cycle. Are we going to get another record, another homer? Something special that Josh Hatcher has been able to do this year. Are we going to see it again today? It feels like we are. Two cycles in the same week. I mean, that's unbelievable. That's history right there. And I just can't wait to see what he's going to do in the leadoff spot.
I'm right there with you. Can't wait to see what Josh Hatcher has in store today. He's etched his name in the Kennesaw State record books already in this, his first season as an Owl. And he's also now etched his name in the national NCAA record books after his second cycle yesterday. This series all started on Friday night as the Owls and Ospreys met for the 94th time in this storied rivalry's history, with the Owls taking that game on Friday night by a final score of 10-6. Jack Myers was the winning pitcher on the mound in that one. They followed that up with another come-from-behind win yesterday by a final score of 17-9, with Colby Johnson taking the win in Game 2. We're going to get to today's starting lineups here in just a moment. We're going to step out for the national anthem. When we come back, we'll talk a little bit more about the weekend to this point, and we'll give you today's starting lineups for Game 3 between the Owls and Ospreys here on the KSU Baseball Network.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network for Game 3 between the Ospreys and Owls. This is a rivalry and matchup where the home team has dominated for the last decade, with the home team winning each series since 2011. Since these two teams have moved to Division I baseball in the mid-2000s, the Owls own a 20-3 record here at home versus the Ospreys. They will look to continue that dominance here today. Let's meet the starting lineups. First, for the visiting Ospreys, leading off and playing second base, number 8, Isaiah Byers. Batting second, the left fielder, number 18, Brock Edge. Batting third, the third baseman, number 13, Abraham Sequeira. Batting fourth, the right fielder, number 5, Cade Westbrook. Batting fifth, the shortstop, number 3, Aiden Swett. Batting sixth, the designated hitter, number 25, Trey Spratling Williams.
Batting seventh, the catcher, number 24, Dalen Leach. Batting eighth, the first baseman, number 11, Grant Grody. And rounding out the Osprey order, the center fielder, number 10, Justin Holmes. On the mound today for the Ospreys will be number 32, a junior, Tony Rocca. And let's set the starters defensively for the Owls. Same as yesterday in left field, number 10, Zach Corbin. In center field, number 13, the aforementioned and has to be the front runner for National Player of the Week, Josh Hatcher. In right field, number 34, Nick Kalina. At third base, number 4, Cash Young. At shortstop, number 2, Tyler Simon. At second base, number 8, the freshman, Hutzman Mims. At first base, the redshirt freshman, number 25, Donovan Cash. Behind the plate, number 23, Nick Hassan. And on the mound today, a junior transfer from the University of Tennessee, 6'4", 205 pound, number 20, Connor Housley, out of Sandy Creek High School by way of Tyrone, Georgia. Last week, Housley went 2 2/3 versus Jacksonville University. Gave up one hit, two runs. They were both earned. 5 walks and 3 strikeouts. And Jordan, the big story today is which one of these offenses can be more disciplined against two guys who struggle with command some.
Yeah, it's going to be about who's going to get on the base pass early on.
First pitch from Housley is outside, and we are underway as Isaiah Byers steps in. 4-for-5 yesterday after an off night on Friday night in which he went 0-for-5. 1-0 pitch downstairs, 2-0. So once again, what we'll be looking for here early on, which one of these offenses can be the most disciplined against two pitchers that historically have struggled with command. The 2-0 pitch from Housley, outside, ball 3. And Byers is quickly ahead in the count, 3-0. As we lead off here, game 3, Owls taking the first 2 games in the series, 10-6 on Friday night, 17-9 in comeback fashion yesterday. Looking for the sweep here at home. The 3-0 pitch, fastball right through there for a strike. Umpiring crew for today's action, Anthony Jordan's behind the plate, Larry Short over at first base, and Jeremy Crow down at third. 3-1 pitch from Housley. That one's going to be outside, and that'll be ball 4. And Isaiah Byers will head down to first base with the first base runner of the afternoon. So here early, Jordan, exactly what we talked about. Who can be the most patient?
Yeah, exactly. And the exact same 4 pitches missing the exact same spots. He did a fastball away. It seemed as though all 4 of those missed rather in the same spot away from a right-handed hitter. It's going to be about where did they miss here today and see if that can change throughout the at-bats.
Next up is Brock Edge, the left fielder. First pitch to him is a breaking ball high and out of the zone. So tried the fastball several times in the first at bat. Tried an opportunity at a breaking ball there, but still cannot find the zone. Brock Edge, 4-for-4 in game 1, 1-for-4 yesterday. The 1-0 pitch also upstairs, just a fuzz, and that'll move the count to 2-0.
That's also something you're going to see. This umpire probably knows coming into this game, hey, this guy doesn't command the zone exactly great. Not going to get the benefit of the doubt if you're not hanging around the zone today.
2-0 pitch. That one's a swing and a miss for strike 1. Moves the count to 2-1. Nice pitch by Housley right there. Low and away, getting Edge to swing and a miss. Took a little bit off. Could have been a changeup. Could have just taken a little off the fastball there. Nevertheless, good pitch to get back in the count for Housley. He sets in the 2-1. Fastball, this one catches the outside corner at 90 miles an hour for strike 2. Waiting on deck is the third baseman, Abraham Sakara, who leads the Ospreys in hits on the weekend with 6. Two two pitch to Edge. Outside and high for ball 3, 3-2.
This is a guy you have to be careful with right here. A payoff pitch on the way. This guy's hitting his OPS is over 1,000 this year, a lot like a guy like Josh Hatcher. This is a guy you can't just lob one into.
He throws over to first base. The check, Isaiah Byers. Good idea there. Byers leads all players today with 9 stolen bases in 9 attempts. So very likely he's on the move here. He is, and he'll take ball 4 downstairs. So back-to-back walks to lead off the game for the Ospreys, And they have runners at first and second base for the third baseman, Abraham Sequeira. The switch hitter, 6-for-9 on the weekend with 4 RBIs, and he's got to like the spot he's in right here. It'll be very interesting to see if Osprey head coach Tim Parenton lets him swing away. I would say that he would, not wanting to give up an out against a pitcher who's not handling the zone very well.
Yeah, especially with runners on the base pass right now, you could, next thing you know, you got an inside fastball, you turn that over to the second baseman, and you got two outs and a runner on third, and that's not really the position you want to be in. With two runners on, no outs, and almost no, I want to say, instinct of finding the zone early on in this game. Something we obviously talked about coming into it. Houses got to start to get some over here.
Now, the North Florida mentality as an offense historically is to swing the bat. That's why we thought Connor Owsley could have some success today if he is around the zone. And I think if he gets around the zone, he could find some success against this very good Osprey offense, but an Osprey offense that likes to swing the bat and does not like to stand up there and take very often. First pitch to Sequeira, fastball up and out of the zone, ball one. Beautiful day here in Kennesaw. Not a cloud in the sky. A little chilly, but very sunny. 1-0 pitch. Swing and a miss on a ball up and out of the zone there by Sequeira. So helped out Housley a little bit on that pitch.
Yeah, that was a green light swing right there. He saw the one upstairs, wanted to lift that one. Just couldn't.
1-1 count. Housley checks. Byers at second and delivers. That one's fouled back to the screen. So Housley jumps ahead for the first time today. 1-2 here on Sequeira.
And if you're in the box right now with two strikes already, yes, that's obviously not where you want to be, but you can honestly look for a pitch a little bit more than you normally would with two back-to-back walks. This one is not guaranteed to be in the zone.
Hassan steps out, puts some signs on, lets the infield know who he's going to try to throw out should runners try to move. 0-2, 1-2 pitch, breaking ball inside, misses, for moves the count to 2-2 here on Sequeira. Waiting on deck is Cade Westbrook, Osprey's top hitter coming into the weekend. 2-for-9 so far in the series. That ball's grounded to second. Mims bobbles it and cannot get it out anywhere, and that'll load the bases up for the Ospreys. So just as you mentioned, Jordan, ground ball to second base. Owls had the chance at an easy double play, just couldn't get it done.
Yeah, that was very close to deja vu right there. But, again, a funky hop, hit him right in the chest, kind of bounced on the ground, couldn't get the handle of it. They end up with bases loaded right now in what's been a relatively easy half inning for the Ospreys so far.
And up steps the right fielder, Cade Westbrook. First pitch to him. Fastball up and out of the zone for ball one. So if you're Tim Parenton and the Ospreys, you got to love the position you're in right now. Bases loaded, nobody out, your best hitter at the plate. Let's see what happens here. 1-0 pitch. Fastball outside, moves the count to 2-0.
And Trey, adding on to that, I think the best part of it, bases loaded, no outs, you've barely had to take the bat off your shoulder.
Haven't had to do a whole lot to this point to get to this position if you're the Ospreys. Very, very good point there by my partner in the broadcast booth, Jordan Griffin. 2-0 pitch. Awkward swing and a miss right there. Ball gets to the backstop, but Byers will hold at third base. It was a very awkward swing and a miss. Another situation where the Ospreys, just like Sequeira did in his at-bat, helped Cowsley out by giving him a strike there on a pitch that was out of the zone. Owsley sets, deep breath, the 2-1. Swing and a miss right there on another get-me-over fastball that was just a little bit slower than Cade Westbrook expected at 86 miles an hour. Two and two the count. 2-2. Fastball just a bit high and outside, and that'll run the count full to 3-2. So here in the early going, does not look like home plate umpire Anthony Jordan is going to give that pitch at the top of the zone. 3-2 pitch. Fouled back to the screen, and we'll do it again. And that pitch at the top of the zone is where both Kennesaw starter Connor Housley and North Florida starter Tony Rocca like to live. So if I'm the offenses for both of these two clubs, I identify that and definitely lay off that pitch offensively because it has not been a strike to this point. Time called in the box by Nick Hassan. And Cade Westbrook will step back into the left-handed box and we'll do the 3-2 again. Here it comes. That one's fouled off over the third base dugout, out of play, and on to Kennesaw State University Drive. No score here in the early going from Kennesaw. Top of the first inning. Ospreys have the bases loaded by way of two walks and an error, and nobody out for their best hitter, Cade Westbrook. The 3-2 again, and that one's way up and out of the zone for ball four. So a run walked in right there by Housley, and the Ospreys take an early 1-0 lead. And that'll bring up who Coach Tim Parrington calls their go guy, their team leader, shortstop number 3, Aiden Sweat. Sweat's 2-for-8 on the weekend, 3 RBIs. He's going to be looking to add to that total here and extend that Osprey lead. And if you're the Ospreys, you know these Owls have the ability to come back, so you want to score as many as possible. First pitch to him is a fastball right through the zone for a strike one. Pitch to Sweat. Breaking ball down. Nice block right there by Hassan to keep it in front of him. And he'll even the count up in 1-1. Aiden Sweat, unanimous selection to the A-Sun All-Freshman team a year ago. 1-1 pitch from Housley. Another breaking ball. This one catches the top of the zone for strike two. That was a pitch that Connor Housley swipe to. I don't know if you noticed that swipe up with his glove was indicating that he was going to change the pitch selection that came in from pitching coach Matt Passour. He wanted to stick with that breaking ball. Let's see if he goes back to it. 1-2 pitch. That's a fastball just down and out of the zone. Trickles off of Hassan's glove, but not far enough for the runners to advance.
It's something Housley's going to learn the hard way today. You have to earn that strike zone with the umpires. That's somewhat borderline right there, even though you didn't catch it. Not going to get that call.
Astute assessment right there. That's one that you learn as you're around the game. You have to be in the zone to get the calls, and if you're not around the zone, those borderline ones don't go your way. 2-2 here. Up and out of the zone again for ball three. Action has started. And the Kennesaw State bullpen is Braden Edson is up and getting loose. We figured we would see Edson today along with Luke Torbert, who are the freshest and best arms available for the Owl coaching staff today. 3-2 pitch. That one's a fastball popped up the right side. Donovan Cash is on the move, but that one's going to land out of his reach. And Sweat may have chased ball four there, Jordan.
Yeah, again, that's the philosophy that we've been talking about for UNF. They show that right there. Swing out of one out of the zone. It's a full count. I understand it. You kind of want to battle. You kind of want to stay alive right there. But, again, you got to make sure that these are good pitches you're trying to hit.
3-2 pitch again to Sweat. And that's a swing and a miss for strike three. So the first out of the inning recorded there on a strikeout of Aiden Sweat. And that'll bring up another big hitter in this Osprey order. Number 25, the designated hitter, Trey Spratlin Williams.
And baseball's funny sometimes because right now Housley is one ground ball away from having only a one-run inning and 31 pitches.
First pitch to Williams is a changeup or fastball up and away, misses for ball one. 89 miles an hour on that fastball. And that's what Housley's done a lot this year. He's put a lot of runners on base, but he's been able to dodge the bad raindrops for the most part. 1-0 pitch. Breaking ball right through there for a strike. 1-1. Trey Spratlin Williams, big home run last weekend in the Ospreys win over 14th-ranked Liberty University as he makes his way back from an early back injury that sidelined him early part of the year. Only his 10th game today. The pitch is lined into center field. That's going to be a base hit, and that's going to get down. Hatcher comes up with it. Here comes Sakara to the plate. There's going to be a play that throws up the line. Sakara slides in safely, and on the throw, Westbrook takes third base. So make that a two RBI single for Trey Spratlin Williams, And the Ospreys have an early 3-0 lead here in the top of the first by way of one lone base hit. That one right there off the bat of Trey Spradlin Williams.
Hey, you play with fire, you're going to get burned sometimes. We talked about just moments ago Housley being able to get runners on and get out of jams. This time it doesn't go his way. You're going to get a single, and that's two automatic runs. Bases were loaded for 10 actual minutes in real time, so that's a pretty tremendous start for the Ospreys.
And here comes pitching coach Matt Pastore for the second time, so that will spell the end of the day for Connor Housley. He records only one out. Three runs have been given up to this point. The two runners on base belong to him, and in from the bullpen trots Braden Edson. We'll come back, tell you a little bit more about him and about what's going on here in Kennesaw State and Osprey baseball right after this here on the KSU Owl Network. We are back here on the KSU Owl Network from Stillwell Stadium. Game three between the Owls and Ospreys. And the Ospreys have chased Kennesaw State starter Connor Housley here in the first inning. And they enjoy a 3-0 lead with one out and runners on first and third. And the catcher, Dallin Leach, stepping to the plate. 2-for-8 on the weekend. But if the Ospreys learned anything from yesterday, Jordan, that is no lead is safe, especially in this ballpark.
Especially with this Kennesaw State lineup they've trotted out lately.
First pitch to Leach is a strike right through there by Edson. Edson on the year, 1-0. He's thrown 9 innings, given up 9 hits and 9 runs, but only 2 of them earned, 3 walks and 5 strikeouts. 0-1 pitch, changeup, down and out of the zone right there. It'll even the count at 1-1 on Leach.
If you want to know the story early on, we're still in the top half of the inning. 3 runs for UNF, only 1 hit on the board. That tells you exactly what the walks have done for Kennesaw State.
One ball, 1 strike, 1 out. And this is going to be a safety squeeze here. Nice bunt down by Leach. Cash fields it, throws to the plate, and it's not going to be in time as Cade Westbrook slides in safely. So textbook execution there by Dallin Leach and the North Florida Ospreys. Push bunting that ball exactly where you want it to be in the hands of the first baseman. Donovan Cash made a great attempt at it, but just not in time as the speed of Cade Westbrook beats that play to the plate. And the Ospreys now have a 4-0 lead, still only 1 hit on the board. First baseman Grant Grody to the plate. Takes a fastball in the outside corner for strike one.
I think that was actually a great read by Donovan Cash to come into the infield, but he had to backhand that instead of being able to get some velocity behind that one to get it to the dish. Again, a good play. Again, just the backhand was really the problem.
0-1 pitch. It's a breaking ball down and out of the zone in the dirt for a ball. If you noticed, as Braden Edson held the ball right there, you saw the top hand slide up on the bat ever so slightly for Leach, and then he slid it back down to try to not give that away. I don't know if Donovan could have saw that. That pitch has popped up on the infield. Cash Young shading his eyes. Tyler Simon calls him off. Infield fly rule is in effect. The catch is made for out number two in the inning. I don't know if Donovan Cash saw that first hand slide up the bat. It's such a great play there with runners at first and third because the first baseman has to hold the runner on. He has to have his focus and attention on the pitcher, so he probably was not able to see that. And by holding him on, making sure that he starts 90 feet away, it's hard to charge in, field that ball, and get that out at the plate. It brings up the center fielder, and he hits a ground ball at second baseman Hudson Mims. He fields it over to first, and that'll end the inning. But not before the Ospreys score four times on the strength of only one hit to take a 4-0 lead here in the top of the first of game three in this series between the Owls and Ospreys here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Ospreys take a 4-0 lead here early in game three of the series. Let's meet the starting lineup for the Owls offensively. He's going to be the leadoff hitter, number 13, Josh Hatcher. Batting second, the shortstop, number two, Tyler Simon. Batting third, the left fielder, number 10, Zach Corbin. Batting fourth, the first baseman, number 25, Donovan Cash. Batting fifth, the catcher, number 23, Nick Hassan. Batting sixth, the third baseman, number four, Cash Young. Batting seventh, the designated hitter, number one, Spencer Hansen. Batting eighth, the second baseman, number eight, Hudson Mims. And rounding out the Owl order, the right fielder, number 34, Nick Kalina. Here's the defense they'll be facing for the Ospreys. In left field, number 18, Brock Edge. In center field, number 10, Justin Holmes. In right field, number five, Kay Westbrook. At third base, number 13, Abraham Sequeira. At shortstop, number three, Aiden Sweat. At second base, number eight, Isaiah Byers. At first base, number 11, Grant Grody. Behind the plate, number 24, Dallin Leach. And on the mound, a 6'4", 215-pound junior from Ponte Vedra Beach, Florida. Number 32, Tony Rocca. Tony enters the day 0-3 with a 4.59 ERA. He's made six starts, 31 innings pitched, 33 hits, 22 runs, 17 earned, 19 walks, and 33 strikeouts. Opponents are hitting 268. Against him on the year. Last outing last week versus Liberty, 4 2/3 innings pitched, 6 hits, 5 runs, 5 earned, 5 walks, and 3 strikeouts in game 3 of that series that North Florida lost by a final score of 7-5. He was cruising right along a week ago, and into the fifth he got 2 quick outs, and then single, double, double, homer for Liberty ended his day. Rocco will run the fastball up 88-92, throw that 70% of the time. And if the Owls want to find success today, they need to follow the Ospreys script and be very patient, make him throw strikes.
This could be a blueprint of what happened in the last half inning. It could really be that way.
Josh Hatcher steps in, and the first pitch to him is a fastball he swings at, and it's a fly ball into left field. Corralled it, and he's got it right there by Brock Edge for out number one. So nice play by Edge. And Hatcher, as he has been doing many, many times in the last couple of weeks, swinging at the first pitch of the game. He's been very lucky with it most times. Not quite right there.
All I've learned is that now it's going to take 5 at-bats for him to get another cycle here today.
Next up, the shortstop, Tyler Simon. 3-for-9 on the weekend for Simon. Fastball right through there by Rocca for strike one. And he comes out firing strikes early. The 0-1 pitch is a fastball up in the zone for a ball, 1-1. Rocca faced the Owls in the conference tournament last year down in Jacksonville, down in North Florida. 1-1 pitch is fouled back to the screen, move the count to 1-2. In a game the Ospreys would eventually win 6-5 as they scored some runs late. He was in a lot of trouble in that game. The Owls scored four runs off of him in that start, but he used the strength of several double plays to get out of his own self-inflicted jams in that start. 1-2 pitch here to Simon is off speed down in the dirt for a ball, and that'll even the count at 2-2.
Rocca has already showed to be the poster child for wildly effective. 33 strikeouts, 19 walks this year. He's got great stuff.
He does have very, very good stuff. 2-2 pitch. Downstairs again. Nice pick right there by the catcher, Leach, to keep that one off the backstop, and that'll run the count full to Simon. 3-2. Rocket kicks and delivers. 3-2 pitches lined down the left field line. That one's going to hook just foul. Home run distance, but just foul. Tyler Simon has really taken off with the bat since being moved up into the two-hole last weekend before the series at Jacksonville. A call that was made on the help and on the insight and information, analytical data given to head coach Ryan Coe by analytics intern Drew Plant, and it has reaped big dividends for both the Owls and Tyler Simon as they are 5-1 or 6-1 since that adjustment was made. Another 3-2 here. That one's out of the zone, up, but a swing and a miss by Simon, and that'll be a strikeout for out number two in the Owls' top bottom of the first inning.
That's exactly why you see the high strikeout rate from this guy. A high fastball, a challenge pitch. Yeah, it could have been ball four right there, but it's tempting to swing at almost every single time. You see that ball eye level, a fastball, that's probably what he was digging in there for. You're going to want to swing at that, and sometimes you're obviously not going to get the call.
That'll bring up the left fielder, Zach Corbin. First pitch to him is another fastball up and out of the zone, but swung and missed that for strike number one. Corbin on the weekend, 6-for-10, scored 5 times. And early on here, Rock is doing exactly what he did in the conference tournament a year ago, getting swings and misses on fastballs up and out of the zone. 0-1 pitch downstairs for a ball, 1-1. So it's really going to take discipline by these Owls hitters to force him into the strike zone or take your walks if they are there. 1-1 pitch. Check swung, fouled off the backstop, and Rocker quickly jumps ahead, 1-2 to Corbin. Rocca has not had a start this year in which he has not walked multiple batters. So you will get your opportunities. The key is making the most of them against a guy with as good a stuff as he has. 1-2 pitch. Downstairs again. And it'll move the count to 2-2. It's a nice stop there again by Leach on a ball in the dirt. Ospreys lead 4-0 on the strength of four runs in the top of the first inning. Owls batting here in the bottom half. 2 balls, 2 strikes, 2 outs. Zach Corbin at the plate. Rocket kicks and delivers. Another one outside, and that'll run the count full once again on another Owl hitter, the second of the day. Owls in their black uniforms with gold Owls across the chest, black pinstripe or gold pinstripe down the pants. Ospreys in their gray uniforms with navy numbers. 3-2 pitch, grounded to short. Sweat has it. Over to first, and that will end the Owls' bottom of the first inning. We head to the second with the Ospreys leading here on the KSU Owl Network, 4-0.
Thank you.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network from Stillwell Stadium in Game 3 between the Owls and Ospreys. Owls have taken the first two games in the series, looking for a sweep and looking to extend their Division I home record against the Ospreys to 21-3, as this series has been decided and went way of the home team for the last decade. Not since 2011 has the visiting team won in this series. First pitch from Edson is a strike right through there to Isaiah Byers, who walked and scored back in the first inning. Oh, one pitch, another fastball over the outside corner, and that'll be strike two. So it looks like home plate umpire Anthony Jordan's going to give a little east and west here, but not a whole lot north and south. 0-2 pitch. Off-speed pitch hangs high and away. They'll move the count to 1-2. The all-time series now stands 50 for Kennesaw State, 45 for North Florida. Breaking ball catches the outside corner for strike three right there by Braden Edson. So a good start here to the top of the second inning for the Owls.
And that is a beautiful pitch. A breaking ball starts out of the zone, ends up right down through the middle. That's something you don't expect to move there. A great job by Edson to start this inning.
This brings up the left fielder Brock Edge. He also walked and scored an inning ago. Takes the first one here downstairs for a ball. So far, big weekend for Edge. 5-for-8 on the weekend. Next pitch, grounded down the first baseline, just foul. That'll even the count at 1-1. Brock Edge, University of Florida grad transfer, has done great things so far in an Osprey uniform, hitting .363 on the year with 13 extra base hits, two home runs. Has also thrown in four stolen bases. Breaking ball there from Edson downstairs, moves the count to 2-1.
And really, look where you're looking for a powerful hitter. If they're hitting above .500 in the slugging percentage, that's beautiful. .571 this year for Brock Edge.
2-1 pitch, fastball, must have been just a little low. That'll move the count to 3-1. Looked like a pretty good pitch, definitely centered up the heart of the plate, just a little down there. So once again, looks like Mr. Jordan will give east and west, but not north and south. 3-1 pitch, popped up. Let's see if this one will stay in play as Donovan Cash gives it a look, but that one's going to be well into the Osprey bullpen area and on top of the batting cages down the right field line, and that will fill up the count at 3-2. Once again, if you're the Ospreys, you know the history, especially in this ballpark. You can't feel comfortable with this lead right now. The first 3-2's fouled over the press box and out of play. If you're the Ospreys, especially knowing that yesterday you had an 8-2 lead, and you saw that evaporate very quickly in that fifth inning.
Exactly.
3-2 pitch. Breaking ball, this one will stay downstairs and in the dirt, and that'll be another walk for Edge. He walked his first at bat in the first inning and came around to score on the Trey Spratling Williams 2-RBI single.
You know, you're going good if you're UNF when your 1-2-3 hitters all already have dirt on them, and it's just the top of the second inning.
First pitch to Sakara, flipping over to the right side. That ball's looped into center field. That one's going to get down for a base hit. And the Ospreys will have runners on first and second with one out. So Sakara flipped around to the right side, the switch hitter, hitting against the lefty Braden Edson. And bloops another single in there, his seventh hit of the weekend. That'll bring up Cade Westbrook. 2-for-9 on the weekend. He walked as well in the first inning. First pitch to him, catches the outside corner with a fastball for strike one. So Edson throwing a lot more in 2022 than he did in 2021. He 0-1 pitch, breaking ball fouled off. He had suffered an unfortunate inner injury in 2021 in a practice drill trying to catch a fly ball. He ran into teammate Nathan Gravett and tore a ligament in his thumb and sidelined him for about 8 weeks of the season. 0-2. Fastball just off the corner. He split Nick Hassan and where he set up, but a little bit too far out for home plate umpire Anthony Jordan to give him that call. And checks second a couple times and delivers this one off the plate as well, evens the count at 2-2. Braden, the Strong Rock High School in McDonough, Locust Grove area. High school teammates with his catcher, Nick Hassan. Both entered Kennesaw at the same time. 2-2. Fastball, this one just off the outside corner and maybe a little down again. And that'll run the count full to 3-2. So not missing by much.
Identical misses too. Three, I think all three of those have been almost in the exact same spot. A fastball on the outside edge.
Here's the payoff pitch to Westbrook. That one's fouled off again. And we will do it one more time. Beautiful day here in Kennesaw. Not a cloud in the sky, a little chilly. We had thought we got rid of the cold snaps, but maybe this is the one last one before we really start to warm up. 3-2. That one's looped down the left field line. That one's going to bend out of play and off the wall that juts out down there from the Kennesaw bullpen. So Zach Corbin will retrieve that one and get that one out of play, and we'll do the 3-2 one more time. Breaking ball, this one again fouled off. So a great at bat here by Westbrook. Fouling off the close ones, taking the ones just out of the zone. Great battle here with Edson. And we'll do the 3-2 one more time. As Edson kicks and delivers, that one is gonna be a little upstairs and that'll be ball four. And the Ospreys will once again load the bases here in the second inning, just as they did in the first inning. So another walk for Westbrook, back-to-back walks for him. And that'll bring up Sweat, who struck out with the bases loaded back in the first inning. Ospreys lead here 4-0. First pitch to Sweat, just off the outside corner. So Edson not missing by much, but not quite around the plate enough to this point to induce many swings from these Osprey hitters. 1-0. Ground ball to short. Tyler Simons got it on the backhand. He'll make the long throw across. That one's going to get over the top of Cash. In to score will be Sakara. Brock Edge scored ahead of him, so that's going to be two runs on that play. And runners will be at first and third with one out for Trey Spradlin-Williams as the Ospreys extend their lead to 6-0.
Simon had to throw that one off of his back foot, overcompensated for it, put a little too much mustard on it, ended up sailing over the first baseman's head. 6-0 UNF, they're controlling this one.
And I think that's one of those plays right there for Simon as Edson delivers the first pitch to Williams and is fouled off over the third base dugout. That's one of those plays for Simon where initially in his mind, as that ball took him to his backhand, he may have wanted to go to third base, but Cash Young, it also kind of went for the ball initially. He was not there. He had to make the long throw across with a good speed of Sweat, rushed it a little bit, and missed just high. This one's popped up. Simon's trying to shade the eyes. He settles under it. He'll make the catch, and he'll hold the runners where they are at first and third. So a big second out of the inning right there by Edson to induce the pop out of a very dangerous Trey Spratlin-Williams. That'll bring up the catcher, number 24, Dallin Leach. He had a beautiful sacrifice push bunt that led to a run in the first inning. We'll see if they do anything with Sweat over at first base. He's got two stolen bases on the year, 2-for-2. First pitch is fouled over the press box and out of play as Edson jumps ahead 0-1 on Leach.
And a lot of that decision right there that you just mentioned, Trey, is going to depend on what do they think Cade Westbrook can do on the base pass? If they're going to think about that steal, if Kennesaw State wants to throw down with a runner on third, that's risky.
0-1, off speed in the dirt, and he will move, and that throw will get into center field, and that'll bring in another run as Hatcher gets to it and gets it in quickly to Tyler Simon. So the ball in the dirt, and Sweat was moving on the dirt ball. Hassan tried to throw him out, and the throw tailed a little bit to the second base side, out of the reach of a diving Hudson Mims and into center field. And it allows Cade Westbrook to score from third. So not the start you wanted for the Owls here, down 7-0 in the top of the second. And line drive right there to Cash Young will end the inning, but not before the Ospreys tack on three more runs. Once again, only on the strength of one hit. And at the end of 1.5, they lead here on the KSU Owlet Network 7-0. And we are back on the KSU Owl Network. I'm Trey Fowler, joined in the booth by Jordan Griffith. And the Ospreys have taken a 7-0 lead as we head to the bottom of the second. And if you're Tony Rocha with this 7-0 lead here, you're trying to throw strikes, force contact. You know how good the Owls offense was yesterday. But if you're Rocha, you're trying to pound the zone and get some quick outs, get your hitters back in the dugout, and let them keep scoring for you.
I mean, with a 7-run lead, that's really what you need to do. I think you said it perfectly. You can pitch a little looser now. You can kind of force things into the zone that you might not be able to do with only a 1 or 2 run lead. 7 runs to work with. You can get runners on. It just has to be off hits. You cannot allow free passes right now if you're Rocha and let the Owls get back into it the same way that the Ospreys took the lead. I mean, 7 runs on only 2 hits.
Rocha faced Donovan Cash. 4-for-11 on the weekend. First pitch to him. Fastball up out of the zone. 1-0. Rocha kicks and delivers the 1-0. This one up out of the zone as well. And that'll move the count to 2-0. Two-oh pitch, fastball. This one's right through there for a strike. 2-1. Nice job by Donovan Cash there. You've had 2 long innings on defense. Be patient. Make him throw you strikes. 2-1 pitch. This one's popped up over by the first base dugout. This one will bend just out of play. My apologies in the first inning for calling Tony Rocha. Tony Rocha. He'll toe the rubber again, take the sign, and kick and deliver the 2-2. Fastball just beneath the zone, runs the count full. So the third consecutive Kennesaw State hitter that he has went full on a 3-2 count. 3-2 here. That one's downstairs for a ball, and that'll be a leadoff walk here in the second for Donovan Cash. So a good, patient at bat there by Cash. Exactly what you want to do. You need to add at bats like that up if you want to get back into this ball game.
That's exactly right. You look that fourth pitch in. The Owls have been in the bottom third the entire year of the A-Sun in strikeouts as well as walks. That means they put the ball in play a lot. You got to change that philosophy if you want to get into the dent of a 7-run deficit.
First pitch to Sons, a fastball up and out of the zone. He does a nice job laying off there on the check swing. Rocha with a unique setup out of the stretch. Very closed off. Tough for the right-handed hitter to pick up the baseball. 1-0 pitch is right through there for a strike, 1-1. The ball will jump on the right-handed hitter, especially a little bit out of the stretch with his closed off as he starts in his setup. 1-1 pitch. Fastball up and out of the zone. The count will move to 2-1. So for the Owls, you want to chip away here just a little bit of time. You don't have to get all seven runs back at once. You want to try and start chipping away. 2-1 pitch. The ball's grounded to second base. Byers has it. Over to Sweat. He dropped the baseball. And this one will be interesting. This one will be interesting. Did not look like he had that secured whatsoever. So now Jeremy Crow is going to have a conversation with Ryan Coe about exactly what he saw. And we'll see if that call holds right there. If you're joining us on YouTube, you can hit the back button there and check that one out for yourself and see if he did in fact secure that ball at all. The rule states that you have to reach in and take the ball out of the glove, which he definitely did not do. And now they're going to get together and see if any other of the other umpires, either Anthony Jordan or Larry Short, had a better vantage point on it.
Now, just from sitting here, it was really impossible to tell because as soon as he gloved it, he turned his back to us for here from the press box facing toward home plate, and I couldn't quite see what happened. Next thing you know, that ball pops out, and it's on its way to center field just rolling downhill.
Well, I think you said the key word right there. He was trying – the throw extended him to the center field side of second base, so he was trying to secure that throw and 360 to make the throw, and that tells you then and of itself that his throwing hand and his glove are not together as you would like them to be as a shortstop approaching the bag or a second baseman approaching the bag to turn a double play. And they're going to call Tim Parenton out. This usually signals the fact that they're going to call him safe here and that he is going to be safe at second base. So it should be runners first and second, nobody out, just judging by them talking to Tim Parenton first. But as Sweat approached the bag, he approached it like most infielders do, two hands together, ready to transition that ball to his bare hand and his throwing hand as quick as possible. The throw took him towards center field, so he had to extend the glove away from the throwing hand. He was setting up, trying to 360 and still get a good throw off, and as a result, he dropped the baseball, wasn't able to do that, and the Owls could be in business here in the bottom of the second with runners at first and second, nobody out.
And these umpires here hearing it from both sides, not only from Coach Coe, but also Parenton.
It's very bad when you're an umpire and the same play you get yelled at by both coaches. You've definitely done something wrong, and you followed it up with something even worse when that happens.
And yeah, now, they're not getting Christmas cards this year from either of these coaches.
No, Jeremy Crow is not getting any cards from Tim Parenton. And now Tim Parenton wants to meet with his whole infield. And I think this conversation is going to be a motivational one. He could be out there saying, look, we've struggled to win here. We're 3-20. Since we made the transition to Division I, you guys have got to start taking care of business. Now you got to beat the umpires too. He can put that in their memory bank and give them a little motivation to try and get out of this inning and keep it a 7-0 lead.
I mean, that's a great point as well, because this offense for Kennesaw State, when they smell blood in the water, they strike. They've had double-digit run totals in the past two games. You got two runners on, no outs. There's a lot of potential for the Owls.
And up to the plate steps third baseman Cash Young, swinging it a lot better the last several games. First pitch from Rocket. Strike right through there, 0-1. Nice pitch right there by Rocha. And we've got some energy now in both dugouts. Rocha sets. The 0-1, that one's check swung and fouled off. That pitch there seeked Cash Young's bat more than Cash Young seeked that baseball. So quickly ahead by Rocha, 0-2 on Cash Young. This would be a big out if he can get it against a very good hitter for the Owls. 0-2 pitch. Breaking ball lined into center field. That one's going to get down. Holmes over to cut it off. He bobbles it. It gets by him. That's going to score one as Donovan Cash comes to the plate. Hassan will hold up at third, and Cash will scamper into second base. That'll be a single and an error if you're scoring at home. Single and an error on the center fielder Holmes to allow both runners to move up. Go ahead and give Cash Young the RBI. 0-2 pitch right there, breaking ball that caught a little bit too much to the plate, and Cash Young did a very nice job staying on it, lining it right back through the middle. That'll bring up the designated hitter, Spencer Hansen. First pitch to him, ground ball. That'll get in the hole in between short and third. That'll score Hassan. Derek Tucker will hold up Cash Young, and back-to-back hits here after the error have put a dent on the scoreboard, and now the Owls only trail 7-2.
Just as we mentioned it, blood in the water. Kennesaw State had two runners on, no outs. Just a couple pitches later, they have two runs on the board. And it's the energy. I think you mentioned that as well. There's the energy not only from the crowd, but this dugout. There's life for Kennesaw State in this offense because they know five runs is almost nothing for this offense so far through the season.
Runners first and third. Now 7-2 ball game. Hudson Mims at the plate. First pitch to him is a fastball right over the inside corner at the knees for strike one.
That was a good pitch.
Sunday's a day where championships are won. They want to call them Sunday grinders, the guys that can get up after two long days and come with energy to the ballpark. Rocha throws over to first base, and Hansen is back safely. It's the teams that can come to play, the teams that can avoid getting swept on Sunday or complete sweeps or win this series if it's tied 1-1. Those are the ones that end up in good spots at the end of the year. 0-1 pitch, another breaking ball. This one tapped over to Sweat at second. He's got it over to Byers at second. On to first for a double play. So a big pitch there by Tony Rocha. Sweat to Byers over to Grody for the 6-4-3 double play. A run does come home in the meantime as Cash Young scores. And that'll bring up the number 9 hitter, right fielder Nick Kalina. First pitch to Kalina's upstairs for a ball with a breaking ball, 1-0. Big pitch right there by Tony Rocha as the Owls are trying to turn this order back over to Josh Hatcher. 1-0 pitches in the dirt, 2-0. As the Owls are trying to turn this order back over to Josh Hatcher, who's been as hot as any player in the entire country this week. He gets the big double play there and two outs to keep him. Hopefully, if you're an Osprey fan, keep him from coming up in this inning, but he's quickly fell behind Nick Kalina, 3-0. And Nick Kalina is one hitter in this Owl order that generally does not swing at a lot of pitches outside of the zone. 3-0 pitch is a fastball right through there for a strike, 3-1. Wouldn't be surprised to see Kalina take another one here if it's not exactly what he's looking for. 3-1 pitch. That one's lined into center field by Kalina. Another base hit. So Kalina's fourth hit in the last 2 days was 3-for-4 yesterday, and he continues his hot hitting against left-handed pitching.
It's pesky Kennesaw State offense as soon as you get the double play. You swap the run for two outs. That's something that I think Rocha is probably comfortable with. Then all of a sudden you get a two-out single and the hottest player in the country coming up to swing the bat.
Kalina at first, very good base runner. Would not be surprised to see him take off here and get into scoring position for Hatcher. First pitch, breaking ball outside for a ball, 1-0. Rocha sets, checks Kalina a couple times, and he delivers a pitch. That one's looped out into left field. It's going to be another base hit for Josh Hatcher. And when you're going good, You're going good. When you're hitting as well as Josh Hatcher is right now, even the balls off your thumbs find holes.
I mean, what? That is a perfect example of the baseball god smiling down on Josh Hatcher right now. That ball had no business finding green grass, but it did. That's incredible stuff.
As Sweat was shifted up the middle a little bit right there, that ball was just out of his reach and brings up the shortstop, Tyler Simon. First pitch to him, fast ball right through there for a strike one. Simon struck out in his first at-bat, swung at a 3-2 pitch just up and out of the zone. Got a 7-3 ball game here. Ospreys on top in the bottom of the second. A lot of runs so far here at Stillwell Stadium on Sunday. The 0-1 pitch, breaking ball up and out of the zone for a ball. Not quite as windy here today at Stillwell Stadium as it was yesterday. A lot of wind all over the state of Georgia yesterday. 1-1 pitch, breaking ball. This one's looped out in the right center. On comes Holmes. This one's going to fall. Kalina's going to round third. He's going to score. Hatcher over to third base. So another bloop single there by Tyler Simon. And the Owls have cut into this Osprey lead. It is now 7-4.
The two-out rally just when they thought they were dead after the double play. You get a single, another knock from Hatcher, and then Tyler Simon is able to knock him in. It's pretty incredible stuff, and that's really what makes offenses great, timely hitting. It's not always about power. It's not always about getting walks. If you can hit when you need runs, that's what makes a team great. And now only three-run deficit, that's pretty spectacular.
And that's a big reason why these Owls are 15-7 on the year, because they have had a lot of timely hitting. A lot of timely hitting throughout the course of the season. They have been notoriously good with two outs, and they continue that here today. It brings up the tying run now. Zach Corbin steps in from the right side, the switch hitter, batting right-handed off Tony Rocha. Rocha a couple throws over, making sure that Tyler Simon stays put. Simon leads the Owls, 6 stolen bases in 7 attempts. They're trying to keep him honest and keep him over there at first base. First pitch to Corbin is off the plate inside for a ball, 1-0. Those throwovers right there usually can serve a couple purposes. Number one, it allows you to check Tyler Simon, see if he's going to be running or possibly or not, but it also gives a little bit more time for that bullpen to get ready, as the North Florida bullpen does have action moving right now. 1-0 pitch is a strike right through there, evens the count at 1-1. Corbin 6-10 on the weekend, 6-11 on the weekend now, scored 5 runs, grounded out to short in his first at bat back in the first inning. Another throw over to check on Simon. He's back in there easily. The pitch, breaking ball, a little high right there. And now Corbin's ahead in the count, 2-1. Left-hander warming up down there in the North Florida bullpen. 2-1 pitch off the outside corner for a ball, 3-1. And that's Ryan Jean warming up down in the Ospreys bullpen. We could see him if he loses Zach Corbin right here. Ryan Jean, a senior out of West Orange High School in Ocoee, Florida. Rocha sets the 3-1. Fastball fouled off down the left field line. Just a little early on that one by Zach Corbin. Barreled it up, but just yanked it foul. So that'll move the count full. They're going to play behind Tyler Simon at first base. Tyler Simon's going to have to make sure that Rocha goes to the plate here, and he'll be on the move when that happens.
Would be a great time for the first home run for Corbin so far this year.
3-2 pitch. Fastball hit high and deep to left field, but settling underneath at his edge, he's got it for out number three. So the Owls score four times in the bottom of the second inning to cut that Osprey lead in half. And as we head to the third, it's 7-4 Ospreys here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network from Stillwell Stadium. Game three between the Owls and Ospreys. And so far, Jordan, it's been exactly what we expected.
Absolutely. Cancel your dinner plans. We're just saying that through the break. This is going to be a long game. Already 11 combined runs. Kennesaw State brought some life back into the bottom half of the inning. Four runs. We talked about it. You can't get all seven back at once, even though they've done that three straight games. They scored six or more runs in their respected half inning. They're going to get another chance to do that in the bottom half, but it has to be through strikes thrown on the pitching staff so far.
First pitch right there from Edson is inside, just missing the first baseman, Grant Grody. Grody, five hits on the weekend, 5-for-9 now with two RBIs. First 1-0 pitch is inside as well, 2-0. So if you're Edson here, you want to come out and you want to throw strikes. You want to come right at this North Florida bunch. No freebies, make them earn everything and get your offense back in the dugout. 2-0 pitch is popped up into center field. Hatcher breaks back, now comes in, settles underneath it, and makes an easy catch for out number one. That's what you want out of Edson. Continue to throw strikes, get your offense back in the dugout, let them continue to chip away at that North Florida lead. Holmes squares the bunt, pops it foul, and over into the North Florida dugout as Eason jumps ahead. 0-1.
It's pretty simple. With seven runs already put up in just two innings for the Owls pitching staff, you're going to have to prove that you can hit it. I'll throw it. You just got to be able to barrel it up.
0-1 pitch. Check swing on an off-speed pitch down in the zone. Called a strike by home plate umpire Anthony Jordan. And Edson jumps ahead quickly. 0-2 on the Osprey center fielder. 0-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. Strike three. Right there for out number two here in the top of the third inning.
And that happens when your offense gives you a boost. You come back on the mound, you toe that rubber, all of a sudden you have some of that juice that the offense was able to put in the bottom half. That's a great start to this inning, exactly what the Owls needed.
It's usually not a great sign to see the leadoff hitter hitting for the third time in the third inning. First pitch is outside to leadoff hitter Isaiah Byers, the second baseman. For the Owls, not so bad. You've punched back now. You've got the momentum in your dugout, even though you're down 7-4. 1-0 pitch downstairs. Nice frame job there by Nick Hassan to no avail. And the count moves to 2-0 on Isaiah Byers. Byers 0-for-1 on the day, a strikeout and a walk. Scored a run in the first inning. 2-0 pitches right through there for a strike, 2-1. Byers struggled a little bit on Friday night, 0-for-5, as he was swinging a red-hot bat with a six-game hitting streak coming in. And the 2-1 is rolled over to shortstop. Simon makes the play coming in, fires across, and gets the out on Isaiah Byers. So a 1-2-3 top of the third, just what the doctor ordered if you're the Owls. And Braden Edson will head to the bottom half. Osprey still on top, 7-4 here on the KSU Owl Network.
Purchase your tickets, call the box office at 470-578-0000. OWLS, or visit www.ksuowls.com/tickets. Also visit university stores for all your spirit wear, textbooks, and technology needs at www.bookstore.kennesaw.edu.
We are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Owls trailing 7-4, but the momentum is on their side after they scored four in the bottom of the second to cut this Osprey lead in half. Want to take some time to acknowledge everyone on YouTube. Thank you for joining in and watching the game today. We'll have some fun trivia for you a little bit later. Today, right now, we want to talk about this day in Owls history. On March 27th, 2015, the Owls defeated USC Upstate 5-0 on the strength of a Jordan Hillier complete game two-hitter in which he struck out 11. The Owls were led offensively by Grant Williams, who had three hits and three RBIs, and Chris McGowan, who homered. Grant Williams, now the Boston Red Sox, just got called up and played in a spring training major league game earlier in the week. So best of luck to Grant Williams as he begins his new season with the Red Sox. First pitch here to Cash, who led off the inning an inning ago with a walk, takes the ball outside and jumps up in the count, 1-0. Rocha still on the mound for the Ospreys. 1-0 pitch downstairs for another ball, 2-0.
You know, crazy enough about your fact, Kennesaw State actually plays Upstate on Tuesday. Former A-Sun opponent. Crazy.
2-0 pitch. Ground ball to the backhand shortstop, Sweat, diving stop, throw across the first, not in time. So a tremendous effort there by the shortstop, Aiden Sweat. Just fast enough was Donovan Cash to leg that one out, and he's on again with an infield single to lead off the third.
If Donovan Cash just has a few more pounds on him, that's an SC top 10 play right there. He throws that over, a one hopper over to first while he's falling to the ground. I mean, outstanding try out there from short.
That'll bring up Nick Hassan. First pitch to him, and that one's hit right on one hop to Sweat, who flips it to Byers over to first for the double play. So they did what they couldn't do an inning ago. Nick Hassan hit a ground ball to second an inning ago. Byers' flip was not handled by Sweat, and that led to four runs. This time the one hop on the button right at Sweat, he flips the Byers over to first, an easy 6-4-3 double play. This ball's hit into left center field, overcomes Holmes. That one's going to drop in again. Edge cuts it off and fires it back in. So another single off the bat of Cash Young. He is 2-for-2 on the day. So how big does that double play loom now, Jordan?
Yeah, you're always thinking about those ghost runners that you could have had on there. Just an atom ball hit from Hassan.
First pitch to Hanson, swing and a miss, strike one. Hanson singled through the 5-6 hole in his last at bat on the first pitch. He was looking to do the same there as he swung and missed that one. 0-1, swing and a miss again, down and away. And Rocha quickly jumps ahead, 0-2.
Got to give Rocha some credit. He's been able to bounce back with runners on base. He's been able to withstand the damage that he's been able to deal out. And Kennesaw State, you do have four runs on the board, but Rocha's been able to tame them.
And throw over to first. Cash Young back. If you look at last inning, he didn't allow the leadoff walk last inning, but the error was not his fault. He should have had two outs there. So he's thrown well, and they're going to continue to try to ride him. 0-2 pitch, swing and a miss for strike three, and that will end the Owls' bottom of the third inning. As we head to the fourth, Osprey still on top, 7-4 here on the KSU Owl Network.
Ongoing success.
And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Ospreys on top, 7-4, headed to the fourth. I'm Trey Fowler, joined in the booth by Jordan Griffin. For the next three innings, I'm going to turn the play-by-play over to him.
Thank you, Trey. This brings up UNF's Brock Edge. And today, he has two walks. Could have gone up to the plate both times with his eyes closed. It would have the same result. He's been able to get on the base and also come back around to score twice. Responsible for two of the seven runs for UNF. First pitch from Edson, and that one is hit out deep to right field. Going back, I think he's got a beat on it and bringing it in for Kennesaw State. So quick out number one, exactly what you want for Edson. Did the exact same thing in the previous half inning, Trey.
Nice catch right there by Nick Kalina, battling the sun. Sun's always an issue here, especially on Sunday games at Stillwell Stadium. Nice job right there to get out number one.
Abraham Segura up at the plate. The first pitch on the way and a strike. Fastball off the outside edge. Peering at the wristband between pitches. Working quick is Edson. That one swung on and chopped three times foul. Having to move out of it is the third base coach. And we see between pitches, obviously peering at the wristband, but oftentimes we'll look dead center at the dugout. The next pitch, fastball off the outside for ball one. Here with one out, a three-run advantage for the Ospreys in the top of the fourth inning. Edson fires, and that one's lofted out to center field. Again, another beat on it. After shading the sun with the glove on the right hand and brought in by Hatcher.
Another nice job right there by Josh Hatcher, shading his eyes, getting the glove up. You're taught as a young outfielder when the sun is up and they're causing a problem to catch the sun with your glove, block it out. Nice catch.
Edson working quick and a quick strike one to number five, Cade Westbrook.
Gotta like what Braden Edson's done here. He's come and he's calmed the storm.
And a swing and a miss on the second pitch. Again, working quick before we even look up from our stat sheet. He's already in the middle of his delivery. The 0-2 swung on, and that one shot foul to the opposite direction for a left-handed hitter in Westbrook.
We've talked about it a lot of times this year, working quickly. That is one characteristic of this staff. They want to get their sign. They want to go. They want to keep attacking.
The 0-2 off-speed pitch, and that one's lofted out into center field. Again, getting underneath it is Hatcher, so a busy inning for the outfield. Three quick outs for Edson. They go into the home half, still down three. Ospreys up 7-4 over the Kennesaw State Owls. This is KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network.
Hey fans, it's time to play Name That Tune. We're going to play a song. If you know the name of the tune, yell it out loud. All right, here we go. Here's song number one.
Back here at Stillwell Stadium here in the bottom fourth inning. The Ospreys still with a three-run lead over the Kennesaw State Owls. Still on the rubber is Tony Rocha, and he has had a tumultuous couple of innings, but also some brilliant moments as well. Three innings pitched, seven hits, three earned runs, one walk, two strikeouts so far. And again, it's been a matter of the contact going the way of the Ospreys so far in the last couple of innings, Trey.
Very astute point there, and with Rocha, he's been himself. He's been in some trouble. He's gotten out of trouble, and the day he really learns to command the zone, look out, the A Sun. He's going to be tough.
First pitch to Hudson Mims rides high for ball one.
But this is typically what you expect from him. He's going to walk some guys. He's going to have some traffic, but he has great stuff, and he limits the damage.
Lefty pitcher fires a fastball, and that's screamed straight back to the screen.
That's what made last week's outing against Liberty so such an anomaly. He got hit, and he got hit pretty hard there in that fifth inning after cruising along for most of the day.
The 1-1. That was another old number one. That one didn't get enough of the zone for ball two. Advantageous count for the freshman in Mims. Right-handed hitter, left-handed pitcher. He delivers and just, I think, gets a bit of that one into the glove, regardless, strike two. Owls in the black uniforms, gold stripes down the pants, as well as the lettering. Grays in the navy blues for the Ospreys. 2-2 from Rocha. That one hit hard, push foul. Trying to make a play in the bullpen, didn't have enough room right there.
Got a small collection of balls gathering on that batting cage down there, down the right field line.
The 2-2. Chipped foul again. Did it get into the glove? No, that one went straight down to the dirt for just another foul ball.
Saw Anthony Jordan peek down there at Larry Short, who was letting him know that ball had hit the ground.
Needed a little assistance there, as well as I did. 2-2 again, and that one skied into center field. Outfielders for both teams being rather busy as that's brought in for out number one to start this one off. That was gloved by Cade Westbrook.
Four straight flyouts here.
Still a three-run lead for the Ospreys in the bottom of the fourth inning. As they face the Kennesaw State Owls here at Stillwell Stadium. Around 56 degrees out. Only a few clouds in the sky. It's been a good one. Lefty-lefty matchup. First pitch was on the way and outside for ball one. This is to Nick Kalina. Tall right fielder here today for the Owls. Rocha sets and fires, and that's fouled off the opposite direction out of play.
And the Owls have defied some conventional wisdom here with Kalina the last few weeks. Gave him the Sunday start against Jacksonville against the left-handed pitcher. He got the game-winning home run in that game. Got the start against the left-handed pitcher again yesterday, 3-for-4, and a first hit in his first at-bat here off Rocha today.
The off-speed went for 2-1. Next one on the way, and that's push foul yet again. Opposite direction. Kalina 1-for-1 today, had a single back in the second inning. The Owls had a lot of promise in that third. Were able to get some runners on. Then a double play pretty much ended what was going to be a promising inning for them. Next one. Off speed again. We'll pull this one to 3-2. Still with one out. See if the Owls can get runners on here. The 3-2 pitch. And that one hit hard into center. Going back for it. He's looking up. It's out of here. Deep dead center. Nick Kalina chips away at the now 7-5 lead for the Ospreys, and he'll touch them all.
He continues his great work against left-handed pitching. Another home run right there off the bat of Nick Kalina. So still swinging a hot bat off left-handed arms, which was another thing that Drew Plant called to the attention of the Kennesaw State coaching staff on his analytical assessment a week ago, and it's paying dividends once again.
Maybe the best part is that this brings up Josh Hatcher as he fouls that first one back off the inside part to the third base side of the screen. One out, now a two-run lead for the Ospreys. 0-1 count to Josh Hatcher. Rocha delivers, and he spoils that one over to the first baseman, a long hop. And he's going to be safe. Oh, no. Out. A play where it was tossed over to the pitcher. Didn't look like he got there in time. Coach Coe's coming out of the dugout right away.
There's not a whole lot that you can do on that one. No replay here at Stillwell Stadium. If we did have replay, that's probably one that would be overturned on replay. Unfortunately, we do not. There's not a whole lot you can argue about. Judgment call by Larry Short. He could have missed it, but it's his call at that point.
Hatcher now goes to 1-3 on the day. Two outs, two-run lead for the Ospreys. Rocha delivers to Simon as he knocks that one off the edge of the bat. Foul for strike one.
What got overlooked in that whole thing is the amazing play that Grant Grodhi made getting that ball to Rocha, and very, very difficult for a first baseman running away like that.
The 0-1 stays up out of the zone, 1-1 now.
When you're running away from that play and you're having to throw it back to the pitcher headed towards the back, that's always the most difficult one for a first baseman. He made it look relatively easy.
Played quite the hop, like you were just talking about. Next pitch, changeup stays down. And usually when a ball hangs up in the air for about 2 to 3 seconds like that one did, a speedy runner oftentimes will leg that one out. But like you said, a good play from the first baseman. 2-1, and that one chopped over to short. Gloved by Sweaty, pops it over for out number three. But the Owls were able to chip away at this one. Rocha starting to settle in here on the mound. 7-5 lead for the Ospreys going into the fifth inning of work. This is KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network. Back at Stillwell Stadium, the Owls trying to get back into this one. Now a two-run game. They did that on the back of the solo jack from Nick Kalina in the previous half inning. This will bring up number three, Aiden Sweat, the man who put away the third out for Tyler Simon in the previous inning. He gets a hefty test swing in. He is 0-for-2 on the day.
We've talked a few times about Tim Parenson calling him their go guy, leader of the team. And the reason why he does that is because he moves on from bad plays so much quicker than everyone else.
Edson delivers the second pitch of the at-bat in for strike one, at one.
That's what Coach Parenson said about him. He moves on quicker than failure from everyone else, and that's why he's so successful.
And he shoots that one out to right field, and that's going to be gloved by Kalina for out number one. Quick out. And you're talking about Sweat, a 2021 unanimous ASUN all-freshman team. One of the few underclassmen that is in this starting lineup, as this brings up Trey Williams, the lefty today. One out, a two-run lead still for the Ospreys. And he takes that first pitch and lobs it into shallow center. Simon gets away from it and sliding grab. No, off of the leather, and that's going to be a whether they mark that a single or an error, regardless, a runner has reached here with one out.
That'll probably be a bloop single there for Spradlin Williams. Corbin came a long way for that ball, slid, and you had a lot of traffic as Corbin, Hatcher, and Simon were all converging. Simon bailed out at the last second. Corbin tried to make a diving play, just couldn't hang on.
Edson with the next pitch. That one spoiled over to Simon. Double play ball, and they get it. So as soon as they come up, they put him back down. Going into the bottom of the fifth inning, the Owls looking to get back into this one. They get a double play ball. It is still a two-run deficit, 7-5. The Ospreys on top. This is KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network. 7-5 game. The two-run lead has it for the Ospreys. Rocha back on the mound, and we were just talking through the break here, Trey, about the pitch count. Only 73 for Rocha right now. Given the fact that he's had a whole lot of traffic, that is certainly a pretty good number, especially given the fact that they've had guys up in the pen throughout this game.
He's done a good job limiting the damage, and he's done it the same way he did in the conference tournament a year ago against the Owls by way of a couple of double play balls, a couple of huge double plays that he's had turned behind him, 6-4-3 double plays in both the second inning and the fourth inning, looming large here to this point and a big reason why they're still on top.
Starting off this inning will be Zach Corbin, 0-2 today. Almost hit a home run that I almost called last time up. Just didn't quite get enough of it. Deep left. 7-5 advantage, North Florida. The Owls have destroyed in the hits margin. First pitch on the way, swung on and missed off the outside. Owls with 8 hits, Ospreys with 2. And you look at the scores again, 7-5. That tells you just about everything about the walks surrendered for the Owls in the early parts of the first and second inning. Rocha steps and delivers another swing and a miss. This time a hefty hack over the middle from Corbin.
Nice pitch right there by Rocha. The change up. Corbin swings over the top up.
Rocha to put away the three-hitter on the way just off the edge. Catcher had set up. Seemed to have split him. Rocha only with 2 strikeouts so far. Only 1 walk. It's been a lot of solid contact for the Owls. The 1-2, that one's shot foul to the screen.
If he can maintain that lone walk total, that will be his fewest walks allowed in any start this season, as he has walked multiple batters in all of his starts to this point.
A great point there, Trey. As the 1-2, fastball stays downstairs, evens up. Coming into this game, Rocha had 19 walks and Housley had 20. Obviously, one of the pitchers got the better of the other, and Rocha has been able to command the zone. 2-2. As I say that, it pulls full. So Corbin with a chance to get on base here, depending on what Rocha throws. The pitch. That one stays up and in. Fastball just couldn't stay down enough. So a leadoff walk. You know what they say about those for Rocha.
Some might call that the announcer's jinx right there, but see if Rocha can do what he's done so many times against this Owls bunch in his last 2 starts against them and roll another double play.
This brings up Donovan Cash. 1-for-1 today. Had a walk in the second and a single in the third. The pitch to Cash. That one off the plate again. And we're seeing that good stuff. The glove pops when Rocha throws it. But last at bat, obviously, rode out of the zone just enough. Rocha peers in, delivers. Same miss to the outside part of the plate. Catcher doesn't even bother framing it. And that is Leach today. 2-0 advantage to the Owl hitter. The pitch. He hits that one out to right field. Is that going to stay in play? I think it's tailing toward the pin, and it will go out of play for a loud strike one.
Donovan Cash with 2 good at-bats already on the day. Walked and scored in the second and singled back in the fourth inning.
Cash batting in the 4-hole today. Playing at first base. The pitch, he looks in. Stays upstairs and in again. So a 3-1 advantage to a right-handed hitter. Runner on first base. 2-run advantage for the Ospreys. The 3-1. That one hit out to right field. It's going to find grass. That's getting past the right fielder. Bounces off of the wall. Runner will go to third. And Cash will coast into second for a very much needed double for Kennesaw State. 2 runners in scoring position. No outs. Still a 2-run game. The Ospreys with the lead, and I think this might be it for Rocha today.
That will spell the end of the day for Rocha. very much like it happened a week ago. Fifth inning was his undoing against Liberty University. It's the fifth inning again here where the Ospreys will go to the bullpen.
So his day is done, but his book is not. A 7-5 advantage for the Ospreys as Nick Hassan will step to the plate with two runners in scoring position. And we will step aside as we have a pitching change here at Stillwell Stadium. Ospreys lead by two. You are watching KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network. A pitching change here at Stillwell. Ryan Jean in the game. What's the scouting report on this guy, Trey?
Ryan Jean, senior out of West Orange High School, Cowie, Florida. Left-handed pitcher. It's a very similar slot to what you're seeing from Braden Edson for the Owls. Velocity is going to be 80 to 81, 68 to 72 on the curveball. He throws more curveballs than fastballs. So for Nick Hassan here, he's got to do a very good job letting the ball travel to him. Not popping this ball up, not rolling over to the third baseman. Hassan likes to hit a lot of balls down that third base line. Wouldn't be surprised to see him hook a double right down there on this guy right here.
First pitch to Hassan, that one outside, and Gene fell down after that pitch. Spun himself around like a top right there on the mound. Got to kick some dirt, make sure that doesn't happen twice. The lefty-righty matchup, Hassan being the righty. Stepping in the box. Two runners in scoring position. And the leading run at the plate. The pitch. Hits that one back toward the screen off the inside screws.
Pretty good approach right there by Nick. He was, for a guy that's very aggressive and usually hits a lot of the balls to the pull side, he looked like he was trying to stay inside that one and keep it in the middle of the field, which is what you need to do here off a guy like Gene.
Hitting 254 this year, the 1-1. He skies that one out to right field. Is that going to fall? The second baseman making his way out. He gloves it, and runners will stay. That was going to be a very close play if the runners were sent. And making his way almost into foul territory right down that first base line to make that catch.
That's what you wanted to avoid, though, if you're Nick Hassan. You wanted to avoid the pop-up. Not a very good job of base running there by Zach Corbin. He got too far off. He's going to score if that ball falls anyway. And he was trying to drift on out with the second baseman running away from the infield there. You want to try and tag on that one. He could have scored on that one. But with nobody outs, don't want to try it. Set it up for Cash Young to do the damage.
First pitch to Young off speed. Fooled him. Four strike one. A swing and a miss. Still runners on second and third. Nine hits for the Owls. Being able to get on base here in the bottom fifth inning. Osprey still with a 7-5 advantage. Pitch to Young. Just off.
Cash Young struggled down at Jacksonville last weekend, due in large part to seeing a lot of breaking balls and not handling them very well. He's going to have to be very disciplined here off Gene. Try to stay in the middle of the field. A lot of good things will happen for you.
The pitch, and he's shoots that one foul right underneath the catcher's mitt. Four strike two, now a 1-2 count. Cash, the all A-Sun conference selection preseason. Grad senior from Georgia College and State University. looking to get these runners in and possibly tie this game, which seemed to be almost hard to think about back in the first two innings. The pitch. And that one shot over to the second baseman. He gloves it off the one hop. That will score a run, so they trade the out for the run as the Owls now only down one. Runner at third base, so a RBI for Cash Young gets the job done.
That's a really good piece of hitting right there by Cash Young. He stayed on the baseball, stayed in the middle of the field, and got the run in, which was huge. The Owls have had a lot of two-out hits all year. Let's see if Spencer Hansen can deliver another and tie this game.
With two outs, 7-6 ball game, off-speed pitch in there for Gene. So we talked about the Owls not having to get all the runs back at once. Four in the second, one in the fourth, and now one in the fifth, possibly getting a second or more. The 0-1, swing and a miss from Hansen. Hansen one of two on the day.
They've done a nice job chipping away, in large part due to the fact that Braden Edson has held the Ospreys right there on the mound since the second inning and thrown up a lot of goose eggs.
Hansen looks in. The 0-2, that one off the outside. Gene with kind of a sidearm delivery. Almost every time he'll finish, not necessarily in what you'd call fielding position, his back almost turned all the way to the batter. So he'll let that arm slot sling him all the way to the third base side. And that time right there is in the dirt, a breaking ball.
The Ospreys still have a couple of their bigger bullets left in the bullpen. And Jason Gonzalez and Steven Halstead, their closer. Be interesting to see when those two start moving down there.
The 2-2. Swung on and chopped into the dugout. Nice play from, I guess, Terrence Norman down there.
Nice play from Terrence Norman. That's been said a few times.
Especially here.
In these parts. 5-year player for the Owls, one of the last guys to accomplish 200 hits like Tyler Simon did earlier this week.
2-2, we'll do it again. That one, fastball outside. Again, doesn't even bother framing it. That's to the forehand side of the catcher today, Leach. And so we will have a 3-2. Gene trying to get out of this one. The payoff, that one hit. A one-hopper over to third, and he gets it over to first for out number three. So a weak ground ball results in out number three, but the Owls being able to pull within one. Still a one-run advantage for the Ospreys going into the top of the sixth inning. This is KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network. It's a one-run game here at Stillwell Stadium on this Sunday matchup, the Owls versus the Ospreys. Edson still on the rubber for the Owls, 59 pitches so far, 4 2/3 of work, and he's been pretty outstanding so far today in relief, Trey.
He's been very good, doing exactly what the Owls need him to do.
First pitch over to Grant Grodine. He scorches that one over to the first baseman for out number one as Cash gloves it. And that's a one pitch, one out, exactly what you want. Edson starting to cruise, has not allowed anything since the second inning. We're in the top six.
We've seen a lot of those first pitch of the inning lead to outs for North Florida.
Have to pay attention. This first pitch is off speed, stays out for ball one.
They are notorious for trying to jump on that first pitch of the inning.
This is to Justin Holmes. Next one bounces up for ball two. One out, a 7-6 advantage for the Ospreys. They did that by scoring all seven of those runs in the first two innings of work. Also on the help with four owl errors this game. Something I didn't even really notice until just looking at it. Next pitch from Edson, fastball. Letter high for strike one.
I think one of those errors will be revisited by the end of the game. The one they gave to Zach Corbin on the sliding attempt he had an inning ago.
3-1 count to Justin Holmes. Holmes came to this game batting 193, and he hits that one, skying into center field. Hatcher using that glove to protect once again, and incoming Corbin takes that one away from him. Pretty much into dead center field for out number one.
Well, right there, Corbin, as he is running towards center field, the sun is no effect of him. Josh Hatcher was affecting. He had lost that ball, so nice, nice play right there by Zach Corbin to make that catch, because I do not think that Josh Hatcher does.
Brings up Byers.
Be one of the few things Josh Hatcher has not done this week.
Also got a base knock here today. The 1-0 to Byers. Numero uno in for strike one. A 7-6 ball game. Two hits for the Ospreys in their seven runs. Nine for the Owls. Edson delivers. Stays letter high. A little bit above that.
Got some action starting to take place down in the Owls bullpen. Edson reaching the highest pitch count possibly he's had in an Owl uniform. Definitely the highest pitch count he's had since his very first freshman year back in 2020.
The 3-1, a swing and a miss off the inside challenge. So a 3-2 count. Now just one pitch away from getting out of this inning too. He delivers, and that one scorched out to center. Hatcher going back and takes about 10 steps back and gloves it for out number three. Edson pitching a gem from the second inning on. He has gone four scoreless half innings as we go into the home half of the sixth. It's still a 7-6 advantage for the Ospreys. This is KSU baseball on the KSU Owl Network. Back here at Stillwell Stadium in the bottom six, where the Ospreys still lead 7-6, but they have been frozen since the second inning, and Edson has been absolutely outstanding in relief, getting another 1-2-3 inning in the last half inning tray.
Throwing strikes, forcing contact, a lot of pop-ups, a lot of flyouts off the bats of the Osprey hitters since that second inning. He's done his job. He's held it right there. He's given his offense a chance to come back, get in this game, which they have done. Owls have been in a lot of close games this year. They found themselves on the winning end a lot of times. Let's see if they can do it here again today.
Ryan Jean will start this one off again. A swing and a miss, Hubson Mims. That one, I think, even bounced in the dirt for an 0-1.
Mims 0 for 2 on the day. Grounded into a double play and flew out to right field.
Next pitch, changeup, stays outside. Jordan Griffith, Trey Fowler. Andrew Pelham on the camera right next to us. Sander Sullivan. And Bethany, I think it's Bruton. Pretty sure that's her last name. I took a guess on that one. Also on our production truck today. The 2-1. Off speed downstairs. Stays 3.
I'm sure she will let us know.
Yeah, we'll find out shortly. At the end of this inning at least. The 3-1, and Mims scorches that one past the third baseman. A diving attempt, but it goes into left field. Left fielder doesn't grab it initially. Went off the leather, but Mims will get the leadoff single and some noise from the Kennesaw State offense to start off this bottom six inning, Trey.
Be interesting to see what they do here and how they play this. Nick Kalina swinging the daylight side of the bat the past 2 days. 5 hits, a homer in his last at bat. They've identified him as a very good matchup for these softer tossing left-handed pitchers. We'll see if they ask him to bunt, move the runner up, set the table for Josh Hatcher, or if they let him swing away here.
Historically, the lefty-lefty matchup favors the pitcher, and a pickoff move over to the first, and they got him. Mims was about to make his way to second base, and a perfect pickoff move results in an out on the base pass. So as soon as it gets up, he's going back to the dugout.
North Florida's had several left-handed pitchers with really good moves over the last several years, and Ryan Jean is one of them. He shows why right there.
So now one out, as that one is to Edson, and it hits off his calf. He showed bunt, and a breaking ball, I think, just got away from Jean, will result in pretty much replacing what Mims were just on, just with one out this time. Brings up Josh Hatcher. 1-for-3 today with a runner on first base. That is Nick Kalina.
Eddie Miller, one of the last North Florida Ospreys left-handed pitchers with a very, very good move. He was a guy that also threw from a lower slot, just like Gene does.
One out, one run lead for the Ospreys. First pitch to Hatcher, stays belt high but inside.
Eddie Miller would step as far towards the first base dugout as he possibly could before delivering the pitch to the hitter. Very, very tough for the left-handed hitters.
Pickoff move over there again. And now, after a pickoff move has already proven successful for the Ospreys and for Gene, that's not going to happen twice for the Owls on the base pass.
Well, you wouldn't think it would happen to a guy like Nick Kalina. Very savvy, probably the smartest base runner on this team.
1-0 to Hatcher. He turns his back at it for ball 2.
Gene took advantage of the freshman Mims early in this inning. I don't think the junior Kalina will give him the same chance.
2-0. Slider off the dish. So a very advantageous 3-0 to Josh Hatcher. You have to think he probably won't see a pitch here. If he does, who knows where that one will end up.
The way he's swinging it, not surprised to see a green light right here.
3-0. He looked that one in, so he was taken the entire way, put the bat on the shoulder. He could take the lead right here if he wanted to. 7-6 ball game. Now 10 hits on the day for the Owls. A 3-1 delivery, a swing and a hefty swing at that and a miss. He was trying to tear the cover off that plus some.
He was trying to do exactly what he did yesterday when the score was 8-7. He was trying to flip it in the Owls' favor once again.
Has a chance to do it right here. The full count. Hits that one over to the second baseman, a two-hopper. Over to second, they get that out. No, they don't. But they don't get the out at first either. Both very close plays, and the umpire signal both of them safe.
That's something you never like to see if you're the coaches in that Osprey dugout. That ball took Isaiah Byers deep into his forehand, deep into the forehole. That is a long throw for a fast runner like Kalina. You would like to see him go ahead, take the out at first base, get two outs on the board where one out gets you out of the inning. because he did not. Now the Ospreys are in deep trouble here with runners on first and second and only one out for Tyler Simon.
And I think I could be convinced either way that both those runners were safe or out. They were both razor-thin calls by the umps.
Bang, bang on both ends. I think Hatcher was more out than Kalina was, but you're right, Jordan, could have went either way.
Runners on first and second regardless, one out, 7-6 ball game. Ospreys in command. First pitch over to Tyler Simon. He shakes his head as that hits the black for strike one.
Exactly. Actually joking about it with Austin Upshaw a little bit after Friday night's game. Grant Williams was notorious for plays like that. We talked about him a little bit earlier.
Gene looks in, delivers, and that one's off the inside part of the bat.
And we were laughing about it because in Friday night's game, Donovan Cash got a ground ball where you would like to see him maybe just step on first base, and he fires it down to second. A little bit more dangerous of a play. He did end up getting the out, but we related it to what Grant would do, taking those balls in the four hole and trying to throw them back to the shortstop.
0-2 to Simon, stays out. Forehand play for the catcher.
And one of the big reasons why your buyers, if you do that, you know that's not a double play ball, most likely off the bat of Josh Hatcher. So just take your out. Even though the runner gets into scoring position, you're one out away from ending the inning.
Gene looks at the runner, delivers another one to the outside. Seems to be where he's missing so far. Hasn't missed a whole lot. Doesn't have a walk so far.
Gene's the type of lefty. He likes to try to walk that outside corner as far as he can. He'll throw a couple pitches on the outside corner to get ahead, and then he'll walk it off to see if he can get a chase like he did from Spencer Hansen to end last inning.
The 2-2. That one hit out to center field. That's hanging up in the air. Getting underneath it, it will drift out to right. Tagging up at second after the glove. Going over to third will result in runners on the corners for two outs.
Another nice job of base running there by Nick Kalina. Your first instinct when that ball is hit is to try and score with one out. Once he realized that ball was going to be an easy catch for the white fielder Westbrook, he tagged, he moved up. Now he's in a great position. Wild pitch could score him, tie this game. You open up the door for what you can do. Now Josh Hatcher could steal second and get into scoring position. You could run a first and third. So many options now with Kalina being 90 feet closer.
Owls with the chance to even this game up. Runners on the corners, two outs. 7-6 ball game, the Ospreys with the lead. They took the lead back in the second inning, have not scored since. Owls trying to get back into it. This is Corbin, first pitch to him. Off speed, not enough to hit the zone. Ball one.
Just down right there. Down. Leach tried to receive that one, did a very good job, but did not get the call of home plate umpire Anthony Jordan.
Corbin 0-2, took a walk in the fifth inning. The pitch, the 1-0. Looks it to the outside once again, and as you referred to just moments ago, he's working that outside corner for a lefty to a right-handed hitter. Gene's 2-0. That one bounces up to the feet of Corbin. And you see the first and third baseman holding their runners on, so there are massive gaps in between the first and second baseman, as well as the shortstop in the third.
Thank you.
The 3-0, he just looks that one and taking the whole way.
If Corbin reaches base here, I think you could see a pitching change as they've got a righty in the bullpen warming up that will most likely face Donovan Cash if Corbin gets on here.
3-1, Corbin swings and dribbles that one through the middle. Doesn't get through, rather. Hits off the chest of the second baseman. They toss it to Sweat for out number three. And the Owls able to get runners on the corners, advance them over, but not able to get them in. A 7-6 lead persists. And I'll hand it back to our man Trey Fowler here at the top of the seventh inning, where the Ospreys still lead by one. This is KSU Baseball on the KSU Owl Network. Jordan Griffith, Trey Fowler here on the call where the Ospreys lead by one. I'll hand it back off to you, Coach.
Thank you so much, Jordan. We are back. Ospreys with a 7-6 lead. And what looked like it was going to be a blowout early or a lot of runs, things have settled down. And Braden Edson has done a nice job in helping that happen. First pitch here to Edge is a ball down low, 1-0. One oh pitch is a fastball, while 82 miles an hour running on the hands of Edge, swinging a miss, evens the count at 1-1. Edge 0-for-1 on the day, walked a couple times, squares around a bunt. This one's going to be foul and put him down 1-2 in the count. So far here on the day, 5 2/3 innings for Braden Edson, tops his career high. He threw 5 innings against Quinnipiac, March the 11th of 2020, the last game before COVID hit. Strike 3 on the outside corner right there to Edge. He knew it and was walking right back to the dugout when that pitch crossed the plate. So a nice start to the 7th right there for Edson.
And that's a great backdoor pitch right there, a lefty-on-lefty matchup, working that outside corner. We actually mentioned that in the previous half inning for Ryan Jean. Edson does it on this side.
First pitch to Sakara is lined through the hole and into left field for a base hit. So Sakara continues his hot hitting. He had 3 hits in both the first and second game. That's his 2nd of the day and the 3rd time he's reached base on the day.
This is an experienced squad. 7 seniors starting in this 7-of-9 squad so far today. I mean, these guys are not going to be fooled by anything. You see it there.
First pitch to Westbrooks, lined into left. If Corbin breaks in, now goes back, and he'll make the catch. And that'll be out number 2 here in the 7th for the Ospreys. So he hit that one right on the button, but right at left fielder Zach Corbin, and that's kind of how the whole weekend has went for the Ospreys. A lot of first pitch swinging, and there are a lot of weekends where those first pitch swingings that they have lead to a lot of base hits and a lot of runs scored. This weekend, however, here in Kennesaw, that's led to a lot of first pitch outs for them. First pitch, Sakara on the move. Hassan's got it. The throwdown will not be in time as Hudson Mims can't handle it. It drops right in front of the bag. So the Ospreys putting Sakara in motion there, getting a runner into scoring position for their go guy, the shortstop, Aiden Sweat.
Sakara, one of those rare combinations of speed and power. 9 home runs last year.
And that ball's grounded up the middle. Mims knocks it down, picks it up, throw to first, and he just gets him just in time by Hudson Mims. Knocked it down, picked it up with the bare hand like you teach infielders to do, and then fires a strike over to Donovan Cash for out number 3. Well, that'll take us to the bottom of the 7th and the 7th inning stretch with the Owls still trailing 7-6 here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back here on the KSU Owl Network. Owls and Ospreys locked in another good one, much as they have 95 other times in the history of this rivalry, with Kennesaw State taking a 50-45 lead. Got a trivia question for you, and we'll answer that for those watching on YouTube here a little later. Who was the last Owl to throw a nine-inning complete game. We mentioned in our Day in Owls history that Jordan Hilliard threw a complete game March 27, 2015 against USC Upstate. Who was the last Owl to do so? Look forward to seeing your answers. Donovan Cash leads off the bottom of the seventh for the Owls and takes the first pitch breaking ball in there for strike one.
Am I allowed to guess here? I don't know the answer, obviously.
We will let you guess if we get no answers, Jordan. Second pitch downstairs, 1-1.
I love that I'm the last resort.
We don't want to ruin it for our listeners.
Why?
If they know.
I have no clue.
1-1 pitch is fouled off and back to the screen. It makes the count 1-2 quickly here on Donovan Cash. Owls looking to rally here. They've done it a lot this year, and they're looking to do so here one more time. 1-2 pitch from Gene. Swing and a miss by Cash. Foul tipped into the glove. Nice job by Leach there to hang on. And they've got out number one here in the bottom of the seventh inning. First pitch to Hassan catches him right in the knee. And the catcher, Leach, appears to want him leaning into that pitch, but to no avail with home plate umpire Anthony Jordan. So they've got the tying run on first with one out, and here comes Tim Parenton, and it looks like he's going to make the call to the bullpen. I think Parenton on his way out right there was also asking home plate umpire Anthony Jordan if he didn't feel like Nick Hassan went into that baseball.
Now, back in my playing days, back in middle school, that was my go-to. I would definitely lean into it a little bit, but I don't think it happened right there.
And that's one that has been changed a little bit over the last few years. They've tried to further define what a hit by pitch is, and I think there for a couple of years they made it very difficult for the umpires to try and determine that. You've seen a lot of controversial calls so far this year where guys have leaned into it a little bit and been hit by a pitch. And I think now the definition they're going with is whether the ball hit you or you hit the ball. And, you know, sometimes umpires even still mess that one up just a little bit by trying to over-umpire that situation. I think that it's very evident when a pitch is one that struck the batter as opposed to the batter striking the pitch. And sometimes they have a tough time with that. New hurler on the hill here for the Ospreys is going to be number 30, Stephen Hallstein. Stopper of the year preseason watch list for him. National Collegiate Baseball Writers, that's their stopper of the year preseason watch list that he's on. Transfer from St. John's River State College, senior, 6'1", 190 pounds out of Pensacola, Florida. He enters this appearance here with a 1-1 record on the year, his seventh appearance, 6 2/3, 7 hits, 2 runs, 2 earned, 1 walk, 7 strikeouts to this point. Opponents hitting .280 this year off of him. He has 3 saves, and he is in here for the Ospreys looking to close this thing down. They're asking a tall task from him, Jordan, entering here in the seventh with only 1 out. They're going to be looking for 2 2/3 from him.
Yeah, it's a long time for a reliever to be in the game. But Kennesaw State, again, you get runners on base. That really changes everything for this team. One run, it seems like that's been one run for the last 5 innings at this point. Can they get over the hump? They have a new reliever to face.
First pitch to Cash Young, stepping in the dirt. Nice job right there on the dirt ball read by Nick Hassan. And he will take second base and move himself in to scoring position right there. Great read by Nick Hassan. 1-0 count on Cash Young. Has delivered a lot of big hits for the Owls already in his young career with them as a transfer from Georgia College. 1-0 pitch, breaking ball, stays inside and high. Moves the count to 2-0. Seven to six, UNF on top here in the bottom of the seventh. Owls have the tying run at second base. And that pitch is tapped over to third baseman Sakura. Long throw across, pulls the first baseman Grody off the bag, and everybody will be safe. And on the play, Nick Hassan moves up to third base. So a ball right there to Sakura's backhand. Had to make a long throw across and just pulled Grody off the bag. And the Owls are in business here. First and third, one out. And I would not be surprised to see a possible push-bunt opportunity, much like North Florida did earlier in the game in the first inning to score their fourth run, to see if the Owls give it an opportunity here to try and tie this game. And here it comes. And there's the bunt down by Spencer Hansen. They're going to let it roll. It's going to stay on the line, and that's going to be a bunt single for Spencer Hansen. And we are tied here at Stillwell Stadium. So all the way from 7-0 down to tied here in the bottom of the seventh. And the table is now set for Hudson Mims to give the Owls the lead.
You could not have put that bunt down with a ruler any straighter than that. That was impressive.
First pitch to Mims in the dirt. Nice block there by Leach to keep the runners at first and second. So a couple of big defensive miscues in this game by the Ospreys have been pivotal to the Owls being able to claw their way back into this thing and tie it at seven. 1-0 pitch is also outside for a ball, 2-0. And the last thing you want to do if you're Halstead is load the bases for the red-hot Nick Colina waiting on deck. 2-0 pitch. Downstairs and all the way to the backstop. That'll allow both runners to move up into scoring position at second and third. Leach tried to backhand that one on the short hop. Couldn't quite do it. As the spiked fastball is always the toughest pitch for the catcher. 3-0 count on Mims.
The last few plays could not have gone any better for Kennesaw State right now.
3-0 pitch. Fastball right through there on the outside corner at 89 miles an hour for strike one. Infield in here for the Ospreys. Trying to cut off that go-ahead run at the plate. Gives Mims a lot of holes to hit through. And that one's downstairs, and that'll load the bases up for the right fielder, Nick Colina. Nick Colina, 2-for-2 on the day, singled, hit a home run, hit by a pitch in his last at bat after going 3-for-4 yesterday. So 5 for his last 6, and he's looking to give the Owls a lead. The infield will play back looking for a double play, and Nick Colina will try to drive something to the outfield. First pitch to him, rolled over foul. Over by the Ospreys dugout. And Halstead jumps ahead 0-1.
If you're cleaner right here, you don't necessarily need a hit. A sack fly does exactly what you need to take the lead. That's really all you want for Kennesaw State right now.
0-1 pitch is a backdoor breaking ball that catches the outside corner for strike number two. Halstead's had 4 straight scoreless appearances. For the Ospreys, 4 straight scoreless appearances. He's looking to try and extend that streak if he can. The runner at third base is his. 0-2. Ground ball foul off the first base side as Colina fights to stay alive.
We've seen both times in these 2 strikes for this at-bat, him reach down in the bottom half of the zone. He's going to try and lift that one into deep center if he can.
Kalina's going to have to stay on Halstead here. He's got a nice two-seamer that likes to run away from him. And that one right there catches the outside corner. Down and away, and it'll be strike 3. And that'll make 2 outs here in the bottom of the 7th for the Owls. So tough call right there on Kalina. Down and away, pitcher's pitch, painted nicely by Halstead for out number 2. But now he's got to face the man who's seemingly done everything this week. 2 cycles, and now he's got a chance to give his team the lead And he's been a player for the dramatic. Would not be surprised to see him come through. Breaking ball catches the outside corner again with a backdoor breaking ball to jump ahead in the count 0-1. He's got the benefit of the doubt on a couple of backdoor breaking balls there from home plate umpire Anthony Jordan in the last two at-bats. 0-1 pitch. Another breaking ball. This one not a strike, down in the dirt. Skips away from Leach, but not far enough for Cash Young to try and scamper home. We are tied at 7 here in the bottom of the 7th inning. Ospreys jumped on top 7-0. The Owls have clawed back 4 in the 2nd, 1 in the 4th, 5th, and here in the 7th. Another pitch in the dirt. Another great job by Leach blocking it, keeping it in front of him, and keeping Cash Young at third base. Seven runs, 11 hits, 4 errors for the Owls. 7 runs, 3 hits, and 2 huge errors for the Ospreys. 2-1 pitch to Hatcher. That ball's grounded back through the middle, off of the pitcher Halstead, over to Sweat. He picks it, throws to first. The ball's in the dirt. That one skips away. That's going to be 2 runs as both Cash Young and Spencer Hansen come in, and the Owls take a 9-7 lead. So a ground ball back through the middle off of Halstead. Sweat does a great job to change direction, field the ball, but his throw just skips away. They're going to score that, a hit for Hatcher, and an error allowing the second run to score. So scored a single for Hatcher and an RBI. His second hit of the day, his 312th of the week. And it sets the table here for Tyler Simon, who runners in first and third. There goes Hatcher, pitching the dirt. He'll have that one stolen easily. So add another stolen base to his tally. His fifth of the year, 5 and 6 attempts for Hatcher there. And runners at second and third for the Owls. That pitch is outside. So the House of Horrors that has been Stillwell Stadium for the North Florida Ospreys since the move to Division I has reared its ugly head again today. They were 3-20 coming in to today. And if this score holds, they would be 3-21. 2-0 pitch, breaking ball inside, and it'll move the count to 3-0 on Simon with the left fielder Zach Corbin waiting on deck. Rio pitch, fastball downstairs, and that'll be ball 4, and that'll once again load the bases, this time for Zach Corbin. Corbin 0-3 on the day, grounded out to short, flew out to left, walked, and hit into a fielder's choice in his last at-bat. More action in the Osprey bullpen. Things all quiet in the Owl bullpen right now. Corbin now hitting for the left side for the first time in this game. Came into the day with 6 hits in the previous 2 games in this series. First pitch, off speed and downstairs for ball 1. Swing and a miss by Corbin on a fastball, running away at 86 miles an hour for strike 1.
That had some Jose Bautista type bat speed to that one, especially with the drawback he had after he missed.
1-1 count, 2 outs. Owls taking the lead here, 9-7. That's a fastball fouled off the screen, and Halstead jumps ahead 1-2. We talked about it early, Jordan. Even with the 7-0 lead, you knew that North Florida dugout could not be very confident given what happened historically here and what happened just yesterday after they ended up blowing an 8-2 lead in game 2. 1-2 pitch. Bounces up there. Another great stop by Leach. He has been an absolute wall back there for the most part, especially here in the bottom of the 7th inning. Two balls, two strikes, two outs here. And the pitch. That went all the way to the backstop, but bounces right back to Leach, who corrals it and keeps Hatcher. Keeps Mims at third base. That runs the count full. So the runners will be on the move here. Big pitch in this ball game. 3-2. Swing and hit high and deep to right field. Back goes Westbrook. He looks up. She is gone off the light pole. A grand slam home run for Zach Corbett. You caught it just a few at-bats too early, Jordan.
Man, Corbett able to put that one off the light pole. He was looking for that inside pitch. He found it, pulled that one hard to the right side. And you also mentioned this. First time he's batting from the left side today, he pulls that one hard to right field and blows the doors off of this one. 13 unanswered runs.
And for the fourth consecutive game, the Owls score in double figures, and Donovan Cash is now up to bat. And he lines one down the left field line. This one's going to be foul. And I want to go all the way back to the second inning and the at-bat that Donovan Cash had, the patient at-bat off starter Tony Rocha that led to a walk and then once again had another patient at-bat for a single his second time up. He's 3-for-4 on the day. And that ball's grounded into left field, make it 4-for-5 on the day for Donovan Cash. People might look at Braden Edson, and I commend him. He did a fabulous job throwing goose egg after goose egg on the board. The guy that's going to be overlooked if the Owls can hang on and win this ball game is going to be Donovan Cash, and he might be the key to this comeback for the Owls today. 4 hits. But more importantly, patient at-bats against a starter they knew had a little trouble throwing strikes. That'll bring up Nick Hassan as the Owls have batted around completely. This is the 11th man to come to the plate in this inning, scoring 7 times to take the 13-7 lead. First pitch to Hassan downstairs for ball 1. 1 ball, no strikes, 2 outs here in the bottom of the 7th. Breaking ball off the outside corner, swing and a miss by Hassan. Evens the count at 1-1.
Now this inning is another extension of a stat we mentioned earlier. This is now the 4th straight game. The Owls have scored 6-plus in one inning.
1-1, another off-speed pitch down in the dirt. Swing and a miss by Hassan. Moves the count to 1-2. Hassan was hit by a pitch, and that's what started this entire mess. Hit by a pitch off Ryan Jean, who was throwing really well. And another breaking ball, swing and a miss, and that will end the bottom of the 7th. But not before the Owls score 7 times in the 7th inning. And they now have a 13-7 lead here on the KSU Owl Network. And we are back on the KSU Owl Network and what has been an exciting Sunday at the ballpark, especially if you're an Owls fan. Falling down 7-0, now they have a 13-7 lead. Remind you one more time about that trivia question. We talked about Jordan Hillier throwing a complete game in our Owl history. Who was the last Owl to throw a 9-inning complete game? First pitch to Spratlin Williams here is a strike, and as he has done all day long, Braden Edson continues pouring strike after strike through there.
Well, just so you know, Coach, I got my guess fired up whenever it's needed.
Oh, the 0-1 pitch is fouled off over the dugout and out of play, and we might have to go to your guess because we haven't had anyone following us on YouTube give a guess. I did have one come in through text message. I need to check that one right now. 0-2 pitch. That one just off the outside corner moves the count to 1-2. The two answers that I have via text from longtime Owl baseball supporter John are both incorrect. So we will go with your answer here shortly if we get no one else to try and answer this question. Thank you all those that are joining us on YouTube. Gavin Redd and Grady Reed. 2-2 pitch, check swing, strikeout on the called looking right there on Trey Spratling Williams. So it took a little time for home plate umpire Anthony Jordan to make a decision, but in the end he calls strike three on that pitch. That'll be one out here in the eighth inning for the Owls. That'll bring up the catcher, number 24, Dallin Leach. He's done a great job today keeping balls off the backstop, blocking baseballs. He had a beautiful sacrifice bunt in the first inning that extended the Osprey lead to 4-0. Lined out to the third baseman and also grounded into a double play in his other two times up. Tim Parenton just wanting to slow this one down a little bit. Talks with him. Might be trying to buy time for someone to get loose in that Osprey bullpen. Earlier they had left-handed pitcher Peter Holden up, redshirt sophomore from Vero Beach. And the first pitch to him is a strike right through there. Makes the count 0-1. So Edson, a career-long outing here today. Another pitch misses away, evens the count at 1-1. One pitch, their off-speed pitch on the outside corner apparently, but misses, and now the count's 2-1. 2-1 pitch, that one's hit into center field. Hatcher has it measured, and he'll make the catch. Another fly out there, induced by Braden Edson.
Man, he's been nothing short of spectacular today. The one that really got the Kennesaw State defense and really the energy going, starting to put up zeros. And when you do that back to back to back, that fires the offense back up.
First pitch to Grodas, grounded over to Mims. He's got it over to first, and a very quick and easy 1-2-3, top of the eighth for Braden Edson. We'll be interested to see if they let him finish it here. We head to the bottom half of the eighth, where we'll answer that trivia question. We'll give Jordan a chance to see what he has to say as the Owls lead here on the KSU Owl Network 13-7. And we are back on the KSU Owl Network. Game three, Ospreys and Owls. Owls looking for the sweep and to extend their home record against the Ospreys since moving to the Division I level to 21-3. They have a 13-7 lead as they hit here in the home half of the eighth inning. Leading off, Cash Young. He takes the first pitch from Stephen Halstead for a strike. Moves the count to 0-1. Thank you for everyone that tried to answer the trivia question. 0-1 pitch, breaking ball in the dirt. Check swung, he did not go, says first base umpire Larry Short. Thank you for everyone trying to answer. Papa Duke answered Tony DeBrell. Tony DeBrell did have a 9-inning complete game, but he was not the last player to do so. Swing and a miss on the 1-1 pitch by Cash Young. Moves the count to 1-2. We did have a correct answer, and that was from Kennesaw State pitcher Nathan Harsh. 1-2 pitch. That's going to be strike three on the outside corner, and that'll be out number one here in the bottom of the eighth. Nathan Harsh knew that the last Owl to throw a complete game was the same Owl throwing in the bullpen right now, Luke Torbert. He did that a year ago at Bellarmine. So, Nathan Harsh, congratulations to you for getting that answer right. First pitch to Spencer Hansen is swung on and missed for a strike. For those of you who don't know, Nathan Harsh was the one who came on in the Tallahassee Regional in 2014 in relief of Jordan Hillier against Georgia Southern and threw some big-time innings in a week, very much like Braden Edson did here today. 0-1 pitch to Hansen is swung on and missed, makes the count 0-2. And as a result, he put the Owls in line to have a big 10th inning against the Georgia Southern Eagles en route to winning that Tallahassee Regional. Popped out of play here by Hansen. Count remains 0-2. They would go on to defeat the Alabama Crimson Tide on Monday in a winner-take-all game and head to Louisville to play in the Super Regional. Still the last team from Georgia to play in a Super Regional. Breaking ball in the dirt there. Makes the count 1-2 on Spencer Hansen. So Nathan Harsh knew it was Luke Torbert against Bellarmine University last year in Kentucky. And that's 1-2 pitches right there on the inside corner for strike three as Halstead catches another one looking for out number two. What's ironic about Torbert's complete game against Bellarmine that day, it followed up an 8-inning dominant performance by Jake Rice. 0-0 pitch in there for strike one. And that was Jake Rice's first start back after having to miss a weekend because of COVID restrictions. The 0-1 pitch to Mims is off the outside corner for a ball, 1-1. So he missed that weekend due to COVID restrictions. Had he not done that, he probably would have had a chance to finish that game at Bellarmine and had a complete game of his own. 1-1 is another breaking ball that stays inside, 2-1.
Which was my guess for all the fans I know are hanging on to. What was Jordan's answer? That was my guess was Jake Rice.
That was a great guess. 2-1, swing and a miss by Mims, evens the count at 2-2. Ryan Kennedy also had a complete game last year as well. But it was in a 7-inning game and not in a 9-inning game.
Was that – who was that against? I feel like it was against Lipscomb.
It very well was. Yeah. Nice job right there, Jordan. 2-2 pitch. Swing and tapped. Here comes Sweat to pick that one up on a short hop. Fires over to first, not in time, and give Mims an infield hit right there, his second of the day, and that'll get another at-bat for right fielder Nick Kalina. Kalina singled, homered, which made the score at the time 7-5, was hit by a pitch, and struck out last at bat with the game tied and the bases loaded and one out ahead of the Josh Hatcher infield single that gave the Owls the lead. First pitch to him is outside for a ball, 91 miles an hour on the fastball from Halstead. One-oh pitch to Kalina. Check swing, a strike right there, 92 miles an hour on that one.
really the story of this game. You look at the hit total, 3 for UNF, 15 for Kennesaw State. You're out hitting the team by 12.
Breaking ball, fouled off into the left field bullpen. And Halstein quickly jumps ahead of Kalina, 1-2.
Listen, if you have 12 hits as a team, that's pretty good, let alone out hitting a team by this amount.
One-two pitch. Swing and a miss by Kalina, and Halstead strikes out the side. That'll do it for the Owls in the eighth. They head to the ninth, looking to close out their sixth consecutive A-Sun victory to start the year here on the KSU Owl Network as they lead 13-7. And we are back on the KSU Owl Network as the Owls look to close out a three-game sweep of the University of North Florida Ospreys and start 6-0 in A-Sun play for the first time. New hurler on the mound for the Owls is the aforementioned Luke Torbert, who was the answer of our trivia question today. He will enter the game. Luke on the year is 2-0. 5.87 ERA, 15 in a third innings pitch, 15 hits, 10 runs. They're all earned. 7 walks and 15 strikeouts with opponents hitting 259 against him. So great job by Braden Edson to give the Owls a chance to come back and win this game. He's in line for the victory right now, doing an outstanding job today for the Owls. His longest appearance in his collegiate career, 7 2/3 innings, 2 hits, 3 runs, only 1 earned, 2 walks, and 4 strikeouts. Luke Torbert recently was on the Riding the Bus podcast where he talked a little bit about overcoming adversity as a player. A really, really good episode of that Riding the Bus podcast, and he represented himself and the Kennesaw State Owls very well in that podcast, talking a lot about how you can overcome adversity as a player and what you do when this game of baseball slaps you in the face, how you can answer back. And he's done a great job of that in his Owl tenure in his fifth year here for the Owls right now. Ospreys will lead off with Justin Holmes, the 9-hole hitter, and then they'll turn it back over to the top of the order for the second baseman, Isaiah Byers. First pitch for Torbert is right through there for strike one. That's just what you want to see if you're the Owls. Come out, throw strikes, and finish this ball game off and the series off the right way. 0-1 pitch. Downstairs to the backstop. That'll even the count at 1-1. One one pitch by Torbert. Lined into left center field. On comes Corbin. He's got it. And he makes the catch for out number one. Nice play there by Zach Corbin. For those of you that are late joining us, the Ospreys jumped on top 7-0 after the first inning and a half. The Owls answered with 4 runs in the bottom of the second to cut the lead in half. They scored single runs in the fourth and fifth to make it 7-6. And then a big 7 spot in the bottom of the seventh inning. First pitch here is a strike right through there to Byers. Torbert jumps ahead again, 0-1. Big seventh, bottom of the seventh inning, 7 runs highlighted by the 2-out grand slam home run off the bat of left fielder Zach Corbin. 0-1 pitch, breaking ball fouled off the plate and then off Byers' face right there. not the way that he wanted to end up his day.
That insult to injury, Hassan takes that glove and tags him as soon as he can if he thinks he's eligible.
0-2 count there. And that reminds me a little bit. First, the 0-2 pitch fouled off back to the backstop. I'd like to send my prayers and condolences out on behalf of Kennesaw State University and Kennesaw State Baseball to Liberty University player Derek Orndorff, who is one of the nation's leaders in home runs, who was hit in the head by a pitch the other night. We wish him all the best on a speedy recovery. Breaking ball in the dirt, be swinging a miss, strike three for Byers. Hassan comes out, fires down to first base for out number two, and the Owls are one out away from a victory here and a series sweep. That'll bring up Brock Edge, the left fielder, University of Florida grad transfers, had a great weekend for the Ospreys so far. First pitch to him is a strike right through there by Luke Torbert. One count, two outs here, top of the ninth. Breaking ball, swing and a miss. Very good breaking ball right there by Luke Torbert. When he's on, it's a tough one to hit. Very similar to what he did a year ago against Bellarmine for that complete game. 0-2 pitch. Another breaking ball, check swing. They'll check down to third base, and Jeremy Crow says he did not go. And they'll move the count to 1-2. And the Owl faithful will have to wait at least one more pitch to close out this victory. 13 runs, 15 hits, 4 errors for the Owls, 7-3-3 for the Ospreys. 1-2, fouled off down the first base side and out of play. So as the Owls have done many times this year, they did not panic when they fell down 7-0. They kept chipping away, and they're one strike away from a victory. Fastball fouled back to the screen. Hassan tries to make a nice play on the ricochet and just misses it. Torbert makes a nice catch on the long hop out there by the home plate umpire, Anthony Jordan. Usually don't see the umpires bounce it back. That's the second one today. 1-2 pitch. Fastball downstairs. Evens the count at 2-2. Abraham Sequeira waiting on deck. 8 hits on the weekend. You know he'd like another opportunity at one. Two-two. That breaking ball stays high and away. So that fills up the count at 3-2 with two outs here in the top of the ninth. The Owls leading 13-7. Three, two. Chopped foul and out of play again. So commend Brock Edge here for continuing to battle. Trying to extend this game and pass it down. Torbert sets and delivers. Fastball just off the inside corner. I thought he had spotted that one up very nicely, but Hassan maybe not being able to hang on to that one caused home plate umpire Anthony Jordan to call that one a ball. So a two-out walk to Edge. That'll bring up the third baseman, Abraham Sequeira, the switch hitter hitting from the left side. Donovan Cash will play behind Edge at first base as the Owls need only a single out to win this game. Sequeira looking for his third consecutive three-hit game. First pitch to him, fastball in the outside corner for strike one. One pitch just off the outside corner this time will even the count at 1-1. You got a very animated Kennesaw State dugout. Did not start out that way earlier today.
Not at all.
1-1 pitch. Foul back to the screen. So the Owls are again one strike away from completing the sweep and the victory.
And Coach Coe coming out of the dugout to shag that foul ball right there.
I can speak from experience. You're a lot more motivated to shag those foul balls when you're one strike away from victory.
That's exactly right.
1-2. Breaking ball up and away. Evens the count at 2-2.
But you as a coach, when you guys are losing, you tell a player to go get that, right?
Probably so. Probably got
hey, Terrence.
Exactly. That'd be a good guy to go get that one. 2-2 pitch. Breaking ball. Tap foul again. So great battles here by Brock Edge and Abraham Sequeira. Both guys that had great nights on Friday night but didn't have a whole lot of help around them. And they could not complete the victory as they fell 10-6 in the Friday night game. 2-2 pitch. Fastball hit high and deep to right field. Sequeira may have got all of that one. He did. A two-run home run by Abraham Sequeira, and he does get his third three-hit game on the weekend. Had the two RBIs right there. So he's showing you why he led the North Florida Ospreys in home runs a year ago with that swing right there. And that'll make the score 13-9 as Westbrook steps to the plate for the Ospreys. The right fielder is 0-for-2 on the day, walked twice, walked and scored in the first. And it's flew out a couple of times since then, once to center, once to left. And the pitch to him, that ball is lined into right field, but right at Nick Kalina, and he will make the catch, and that will end the ball game as the Kennesaw State Owls polish off a great weekend of baseball, great week of baseball, 4-1, 3-0 on the weekend. They'll start A-Sun play 6-0 for the first time in Division I history. Jordan Griffith. The game started out how we thought it might start out, with a little lack of command from both pitchers. But did you see the comeback coming?
It's hard to say I didn't see it coming, but also hard to say that I saw it coming at the first place. I mean, 7-0. I mean, Kennesaw State looked dead in the water, let's be honest. But I think maybe the most impressive part about this win is they win 13-9. And Josh Asher only really had a single. It was everybody else today. For the Owls, this team was unflappable. 7 runs down. 9 times out of 10, Trey. 9 times out of 10. You get down 7 runs, you're losing that ball game. Kennesaw State has gone down in the last 2 games, and they've been able to come back and win in really coast to wins, which is really crazy to think about. Usually it'll take you all 9 innings to come back from a 7-0 deficit, but only took them 7, and this is the result that we get.
Absolutely, and they've done what they've done all year. They've not shied away when they've went down, and they've taken some leads in some games and saw other teams come back and beat them, and they turn the tide this weekend. They flip the script on the Ospreys. They continue their dominance over the Ospreys at home, moving to 21-3 in the Division I era, and now taking a 51-45 series advantage. That'll close it out for today from Stillwell Stadium. For the production staff and my partner Jordan Griffith, I'm Trey Fowler. Thank you so much for joining us. The Owls return back to action on Tuesday here at from Stillwell Stadium against USC Upstate. It'll be live once again on YouTube. I'll be back with you in a couple of weeks as the Owls return home for A-Sun play, and I look forward to seeing you then. Until then, God bless, and we wish all our listeners all the best. From Kennesaw, Georgia, Owls win 13-9 and sweep the Ospreys here on the KSU Owl Network.